to Capital One Bowl Mania.
You're watching the ServPro First Responder Bowl as part of Capital One Bowl Mania, and it is an absolutely gorgeous day here in the heart of Dallas, Texas. We're on the campus of Southern Methodist University for this ServPro First Responder Bowl. Western Kentucky out of Conference USA, Western Michigan out of the MAC, 8-4 against 7-5 from Gerald Ford Stadium. And a pleasant good afternoon or good morning, depending on where you are. Dave Neal alongside former University of Georgia SEC Championship quarterback DJ Shockley. And DJ, you had a chance to participate in many bowl games, but how important is this to the players, especially those seniors?
Well, it's really important because you think about, there's a long season. You got some ups, you got some downs, but you have an opportunity to go out and finish maybe your career out in the right way. So it's a combination of, hey, now we get rewarded for some of the good things we did all year. And for seniors, this is a game you never forget.
And there are a lot of seniors that will be big playmakers today. And for Western Michigan, one of those is number two in the backfield, Levante Bellamy. Folks, if you don't know his story, he's unbelievable. Over 1,400 yards, 23 rushing touchdowns. He has been a beast all season for the Broncos.
Yeah, I've loved watching Levante Bellamy on tape. The things that he does is pretty precise and really good. I mean, the one thing that makes him so special is what he can do in space. They want to get him the football in space, and his receivers block really well on the perimeter. But also, if he gets any type of leverage, Junior, he gets space in between him and the defender, forget about it. He's going to make you miss, and that's one of the best attributes about him is his ability to make guys miss in space. And then you talk about the power. You talk about his vision, his focus inside. And there are multiple guys who can make plays on him, but he is the type of guy, when he gets close to the goal line, he is going to finish runs and finish with some authority. This is a guy, 8 times this year, he's rushed for over 100 yards or more. So he will be a stalemate of this offense today.
A MAC Offensive Player of the Year. We'll see him a lot. Good quarterback, John Wasink, that will run the show for them. Meanwhile, for this Western Kentucky football team, obviously, this is a team that came off 3 wins just a year ago. So getting here to this bowl game, a big deal, especially for guys like Lucky Jackson. They always say it's good to be lucky, but it's good to be lucky. Well, it's really good to be lucky today because he's going to go out, and they're going to use him a lot. Just an outstanding wide receiver.
And Lucky is really good, and he's the main guy for this football team. And when you're trying to throw the football down the field, he is the number one guy you're looking for. He runs really good routes. He's precise in him. But what he does after the catch makes him really special. And this will be a guy that Ty Stewart looks for majority of the ball game today.
Yeah, 25 catches the last 2 games, 52 over the last 6. A big reason why this Hilltopper team has had a major turnaround under their coach, Tyson Helton. For more on that story, let's go downstairs, check in with Dawn Davenport.
Yeah, Dave and DJ, Tyson Helton inherited a Western Kentucky team that went 3-9 last year with just 2 conference wins. The thought was that this was going to be a rebuilding year. Coach even admitted to us, even in the fall, he didn't know if this group would come together. And then week 1, they lose to Central Arkansas, an FCS team. But Coach Helton told me this group developed a chip on their shoulder and flipped the switch. They beat FIU the next week, and oh, what a turnaround it has been so far. Guys, Coach Helton called this a very special group as they look to cap off one of the biggest turnarounds in college football this year with win number 9 today.
Yeah, third best turnaround in the FBS. Tyson Helton, the offensive coordinator at Tennessee just a year ago, returning to a place where he was OC for a few seasons. And boy, they have taken to his style of play very well over on the Hill. Meanwhile, Western Michigan, of course, back in 2016, captured the attention of college football fans under the direction of P.J. Fleck. 13 wins, went to the Cotton Bowl. But it seems like Tim Lester, who has taken over this job after Coach Fleck left, has developed a good foundation. They have picked up additional wins each year since he has been the head coach. So Western Kentucky wins the toss. They defer. So Western Michigan will get it first, and they'll have good field position out around the 35-yard line. And the man who's in charge of this offense is John Wasink. How about him? Just shy of a 4.0 GPA, graduated now with getting his master's degree. Member of the Broncos Buddies in Kalamazoo, Michigan, one of 12 finalists for the Campbell Award Trophy given out by the National Football Foundation, and also just picked up the prestigious Werfel Trophy. This guy is the complete package and is healthy this year. One of the reasons that this Western Michigan club is here in the First Responders Bowl. You see his coach, he maximizes everything that he does on and off the field, John Wasink. What do you like about Wasing under center?
Well, the number one thing is he is a really good decision maker. Doesn't turn the football over and makes all the decisions at the line of scrimmage for this team. And he will get them into a lot of good plays today just off what he sees pre-snap.
4 yard pickup on that first play. Then they give it back to Levante Bellamy. He's out over the 40 to about the 43-yard line. Give him a couple of yards on that. So it should be third down and about four coming up for the Broncos. Wasink on the year has completed just shy of 60% of his passes, 19 touchdowns, 7 interceptions. His last game, though, not so good. A loss to Northern Illinois Thanksgiving weekend. And as coaches put it, in a snow globe type atmosphere. So third down coming up for the Broncos. Hilltoppers bringing some pressure. They get the pass off. It's caught by their tight end, Gio Ricci, and he'll have the first down near midfield around the 49. That's a pickup of 7.
Get used to hearing that name a lot today. Ricci is one of their top players on this offensive side of the football this year. He's got 47 catches on the year, but he is the safety valve for sure when you think about throwing the football.
He'll run it with Bellamy, and he is stopped behind the line of scrimmage. That'll be a loss of 2 on the play. Giovanni Ricci, the senior out of Loveland, Ohio. We'll see a lot of him today, as you talked about. One of the big impact players for this Western Michigan football team. And keep an eye on number 10 for Western Kentucky, the defensive end, D'Angelo Malone. 90 tackles on the year, the Conference USA Defensive Player of the Year. On second down, Wasink going up top, tight spiral, near sideline. That pass is incomplete. There are no flags on the play. Trying to hit a bustle with that one, and a little bit underthrown.
They like the matchup here. You get one-on-one on the outside. This is just a football he has to put on the outside. They're playing man coverage on the outside. He has to throw this football out to give him an opportunity. Tries to come back for the football, but just not able to come down with it. But a perfect ideal on there on second down, trying to hit a big play down the sideline.
So now it's third down. We'll call it 10. Tucker in the game at running back. He stands to the right of Wasink. They'll bring Ricci in motion. Wasink coming to his tight end. Ricci needs to make a man miss. Does so. Gets close to the line to gain. Needed to get it inside the 41. They'll spot it right around the 41. Actually, they will spot it back around the 42, so he'll be a yard shy, but there is a flag down in the backfield. As our referee today, Jeremy Parker out of the Sun Belt Conference.
During the play, personal foul, offense, number 61, unnecessary roughness, 15-yard penalty, replay, third down.
Mike Caliendo is your left guard. He's going to get called for the penalty, and he's a guy who's played a lot of football for this Western Michigan team, 35 games started in his career, but I know a play he would wish he can have back. Putting this Western Michigan offense in third and long.
Yeah, this is an offensive line that you go down the list, 25 career starts, 35 career starts, 51 straight starts for their center, Luke Jariga, the senior out of Aurora, Illinois. But now it is third down and 25. He'll come near side with Bellamy, and he'll get it out to the 36. So the Hilltoppers get a stop defensively and force a fourth down.
Good defensive series there for Western Kentucky, getting off the field on, obviously, on third down. Well, they forced a lot of bad plays there for that Western Michigan on that first drive.
Nick Mahalik will punt it away, the sophomore out of Skokie, Illinois, averaging 42 yards per punt this season. Averaged 45 yards per punt in that snowstorm against Northern Illinois back in late November. Back to return is Pearson. He will field it around the 12, and he'll get it out to the 20-yard line, a 53-yard punt. We'll step aside. Hilltoppers with the football when we come back. Well, when the season started, Ty Story was a spectator on the sidelines of Western Kentucky after transferring in from Arkansas. He went to Arkansas as a four-star pocket passer, one of the highly talented quarterbacks coming out of the state of Arkansas, but went 0-9 in the great state of Arkansas, decided to enter the transfer portal, just didn't work out with Chad Morris. Committed to Western Kentucky, lost the starting job to Stephen Duncan, but he was injured in week three. And they turned it over to Ty Story, and all he has done is win 7 of 9 games. When things don't go your way, you keep grinding and wait your turn. That's exactly what Ty Story has done, and now he leads this Hilltopper team into the First Responder Bowl. And it has been a solid season for the 2019 Conference USA Newcomer of the Year, 7-2 in this starting role.
Ty Story is one of those type of guys you root for. And everybody on this Western Kentucky team has kind of just got behind him and said he's going to be our leader, and he has definitely led them, and he's 7-2 as a starter, playing really well.
Lucky Jackson with the first catch of the game. Now they'll try a little flea flicker. Story going deep down the field and just overthrows Lucky Jackson. Lucky had a step on Justin Tranquil, who was the man back in coverage. But Ty Story talking to him yesterday, the connection with him and Lucky Jackson, they just clicked. You don't see that very often with a guy that just rolls into campus back in early August.
And I had a chance to talk to Lucky, and he said he thought he would be the guy, especially early in the year when they started the season, just because of his attitude and demeanor when he's on the field. So he's glad this guy's out there.
They'll swing it near side. Gage Walker, their outstanding running back, hit around the 34-yard line by Trey Hayward. But we've got a lot of all-conference-type players out there. Hayward's one of those, the MAC Defensive Player of the Year, now with 133 tackles on the year. 8 games this season with 10 or more tackles.
Insane. And you're talking about being around the football every single play. The instincts, he sees stuff really well. And when he sees it, he is downhill and he is shot out of a cannon. He is going to be a fun player to watch today.
Averaging 11 tackles per game. That's 6th best in the FBS. 3rd down and 9 coming up for the Hilltoppers. 4-man rush from Western Michigan. Story, who loves to run it when he has an opportunity, creates some space, throws, and that one is picked off around the 30-yard line by Western Michigan. Alex Grace comes up with the pick, the senior linebacker.
Story has Ja'Core Pearson running wide open, but you can just see not enough arm strength to get this football down the field. He doesn't get it far enough, and just an outstanding play to catch this football and get an interception for his team and turn the football over. First big turnover of the game. This is a team that doesn't really turn the football over. Ty Story in his ball game has played really well. He had went 92 consecutive passes without an interception.
So the Broncos will take over just outside the 30-yard line. Ty Story, 6th interception of the year to go along with those 12 touchdown passes. So Wasink and the shotgun coming near side. That pass is caught by Deshaun Bussell, and he'll pick up 4.
Now you want to get your quarterback just kind of calm down in his ball game. Give him a couple early completions. The first drive, you got a couple easy completions to Richie, and then you had the penalty that set you back. Staying ahead of the chains is most important for Western Michigan and Wasing.
Tucker checks in. He'll line up at the tailback spot in that pistol formation. Giovanna Richie in motion to tight end. Gets a good block that allows Tucker to get it over the 40 out near the 44-yard line. Picks up 9, and that'll move the chains.
Tucker's no stranger to carrying the football as well. A more downhill physical runner at 210 pounds. And one of the guys who's a senior playing in one of his last ball games wants to put on a good display.
Tim Lester tells you it's a first down. 2nd straight bowl appearances in his 3rd year as the head coach. An offensive mind. Graduated from Western Michigan back in 2000, was an outstanding quarterback. Here's Wasink. He'll keep it off the right side. He'll pick up 3 or 4 yards on that one. Brought down by D'Angelo Malone, that outstanding defensive end, the Conference USA Defensive Player of the Year.
The speed of Malone there is the difference. He ended up crashing all the way down and being able to run Wasink down to keep it to a 2nd and 7 or 8 here, but Malone is one of those type of players that can play outside, he can play inside, can rush the passer. Just a versatile guy off the edge.
hand it off to Tucker. Another big run. Runs over a Hilltopper into Western Kentucky territory after an 11-yard pickup for the 5'8", 210-pound senior.
Left tackle Jalen Moore, what a block on the edge there to create the huge run lane to run through for Tucker, and he makes that defender play at the end with a tough, hard, physical run for another 2 or 3 yards.
They call Tucker the Thunder to Bellamy's Lightning. First down and 10. Wasink looking to throw, dumps it off underneath, pass is caught there inside the 35. Sky Moore, the freshman, picks up 8. Sky Moore is a guy that you will see a lot of. Those that follow the MAC, you'll see him a bunch in the coming years. An outstanding true freshman wide receiver.
Came in as a safety, corner type guy on the defensive backside, and now he's playing receiver and one of the top receivers for Western Michigan.
So Sean Tyler in the game at running back, the third running back used by the Broncos. He stands to the left of Wasink. They say Tyler's the flash to the thunder and lightning of Devon Tucker and Levante Bellamy. They'll hand it to him. Get it to the 31, pickup of 3. Western Michigan started the year 4-4. All 4 of those losses came on the road. And this is a team that got it cranked up. They won 3 of their last 4 and felt like this was a team that should have been playing for a MAC championship, and they just stubbed their toe along the way.
Yeah, a couple games they were in and thought they had an opportunity to win and just weren't able to finish those ball games off. And here's an opportunity here. Wasik here at the line of scrimmage seeing something in the secondary and wants to change it and get this team into a better play.
First down and 10. Near side throw incomplete. Trying to hit Sky Moore again. Matter of fact, Western Michigan beat the 2 teams that did play in the MAC championship. So Tim Lester was telling us that doesn't make you feel really well.
Yeah, see, we beat both those teams by a couple of touchdowns, so they feel really good about that, not being able to play in their conference championship game.
Felt like they left a lot on the table this year, especially with a senior-laden, very balanced team. They've got a lot of weapons offensively they can go to, play different styles of football if need be. That handoff will pick up just 1 yard. It goes to Sean Tyler, the true freshman. Kyle Bailey making the play. Linebacker who started last year as a safety. They move him down to the linebacker spot, and all he has done is produce a 100-tackle season for you.
We talked to him yesterday, and all he said he wanted to do is hit people. He said, that's the only thing I wake up and go to sleep thinking about is hitting people. And he was more fitted to play linebacker than safety because he was never near the action playing in the secondary.
Well, you see what Western Kentucky's done on third down and short this year. They have been dynamite. Tucker in the game at running back. Wasink. Throws, steps up in the pocket, fires a strike to the far sideline. That pass is caught. That'll be a first down inside the 20. A pickup of 13 as Sky Moore hung on to it near that far sideline.
Love the comeback route on the outside by Sky Moore and the timing of Wasink to get that football out and put it on him as soon as he comes out of the break. That tells you those guys are in sync and they play a lot of football together, that they trust each other on both sides of the ball to get that football out and then for him to come out of him and make a pretty good catch.
10th play of this drive. Levante Bellamy back in at running back. We'll toss it to him. Coming to the wide side of the field. Hilltopper stretch it out nicely. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 white jerseys around that football. A gain of 2 led by Clay Davis.
We had a chance to talk to defensive coordinator Clay White. He talked about the strength of this Western Kentucky team has been up front. They haven't been pushed around a lot this year. And you can see that early in this ball game in the run game, they're really stout at the point of attack. And like you just mentioned, Dave, they got 4 or 5 guys always running to the football.
Bellamy stays in the game at running back. A couple of tight ends for the Broncos. Red zone offense. That handoff goes to Levante Bellamy, who is Mr. Touchdown this year with 23 rushing touchdowns.
Workhorse he has been, averaging 5.6 yards a carry on the season, and truly been a workhorse. We talked about over 248 carries coming into this ball game, and when they needed it most, he's been the guy to carry it for them. But brings up a critical third down here. They want to keep this drive going, try to get 6.
Western Michigan, 2 out of 3 on third down conversions. Another one here. This one, third down and 5. Wasink will throw on the run. Back of the end zone. Trying to hit Ricci with it, and it's incomplete. Batted out of there by Roger Craig.
Love Wasink climbing up in the pocket, trying to throw the football. Roger Craig, though, matched up against the bigger Ricci. At the end, gives a good job of just getting that hand in there, knocking that football out, continuing to fight through on that play and stick to his receiver, and he's rewarded with the pass breakup.
So Western Michigan will go with Tiago Capps on a 39-yard field goal attempt. They have been switching between Capps and Petty. They will actually spot this right at the 30-yard line. I mean, the 20-yard line, so a 30-yard field goal attempt from Capps, who was 8 out of 13 on the season. And he will hammer this one through the uprights. So the Broncos on the board first. Nice drive, ends in 3. Back in a moment.
The ServPro First Responder Bowl. Brought to you by 1-800-SERV-PRO. Helping make fire and water damage like it never even happened. Tempur-Pedic. Tempur-Pedic provides truly transformative sleep all night, every night. And Lexus. Experience amazing.
Well, we're at the ServPro First Responder Bowl, and some of those first responders showed up at each team's practices this week. The Dallas Police K-9 unit visited both teams. And I got to tell you something. Each team's trainers surprised their teams by dressing up in that bite suit. I'm not so sure I'd volunteer for that.
So there's no way you do it?
No. Sorry. I draw the line.
I'm always afraid. Yeah. As soon as I get in the suit, that's when something happens and the suit doesn't hold up.
But how about those dogs? I mean, as soon as the trainers told them to release, they came running back to the trainers, and then they walk. I don't know. I mean,
so trained. Whew. I know Dawn wishes she can have those same trainers. Dawn has a few dogs herself.
That'll be a flag as that kick goes out of bounds. They'll bring that out to the 35-yard line.
Free kick out of bounds. Kicking team, number 39. Ball will be placed at the 35-yard line. First down, Western Kentucky.
So Western Kentucky brings their offense back on the field. Western Kentucky averaging 25.5 points a game, but got their offense cranked up a little bit down the stretch. Going 45, 31, 28 points in their last 3 games. All wins heading into this First Responder Bowl. Gage Walker on that carry. Zaire Barnes making the tackle. This looks like an injured Hilltopper offensive lineman, slow to get up. Tyler Witt, the left guard. 30 consecutive starts for Tyler. Out of Joliet, Illinois. There is a look at the defensive coordinator for Western Michigan, Lou Esposito.
Big Lou, as he said, we can call him. He said only his friends call him Big Lou, so that means we're friends now. When we met him yesterday and talked to him, guy full of energy. He had tons of energy in our meeting, and he is one of those guys those kids love to play for.
A lot of energy, very positive guy. he'd be fun. He'd be fun to play for. Second down and 9. Here's Story. Keeps it himself. He'll get it out to the 41. Let's go down to Dawn.
Hey, you guys talking about that energy from Big Lou. Oh, yeah, you can feel it down here. You want to get hyped? You want to get motivated? Spend about 2 minutes on the sideline with Big Lou. He just told his defense before they came back out, all right, come on, we need 2 more turnovers. That's it. It's contagious, I tell you guys. He said he's a glass half full kind of guy. His players said never a dull day with Coach Espo, and that they feed off of that energy. That's their motto. You're seeing it on the field too.
And they shaved on 8 points off their total allowed from a year ago. City really simplified this defense. Guys just playing fast. Bringing some heat here on Ty Story. Pass is a little bit behind. I think Story had to rush that throw, causing the incompletion, trying to hit Pearson with it.
Yeah, Big Lou bringing the pressure there. Not allowing Ty Story to sit back and see what's going on. And Hayward again coming in on the pressure. to force that football out of the hands of Ty Story a little bit quicker than he wanted to. And fortunately for him, the ball wasn't intercepted because he was thrown behind it.
So the Hilltoppers will have to punt it away. John Haggerty averaging 46.2 yards a punt. That is a Western Kentucky record for an average in a season. 42 punts on the year, 16 over 50 yards, but this one is not a good one. Not his best effort. Let's see where they end up spotting this one. Around the 30-yard line. So Big Lou's defense coming up big, giving his offense the football. Back in a moment. Next, we'll take you out to Nissan Stadium in Nashville. Running back Kylan Hill needs just 47 yards for the school's single-season rushing title. Leads Mississippi State against Scott Scatterfield's Louisville Cardinals in the Franklin American Mortgage Music City Bowl. And after that one, it's the Capital One Orange Bowl. Kyle Trask leads number 9 Florida against quarterback Bryce Perkins. And Virginia from Hard Rock Stadium in Miami. It's the Cavaliers' first trip to the Orange Bowl. Be facing an outstanding Florida defense, over 40 sacks on the year. Top 5 in the country. Ricci with the drop pass around the 31-yard line. Western Kentucky really swarming to the football defensively.
A lot of chrome helmets getting to the football and trying to make plays on the ball and not allowing them to have the big plays down the field. Jalen George running from his D-line spot, getting outside to force that football out from Ricci.
Second down and 10. Broncos in that pistol formation. That last drive by Western Michigan went 13 plays, 57 yards. They'll hand it off to Bellamy here. He'll pick up a couple of yards, so third down and long coming up for the Broncos.
Western Kentucky kind of lives their defense by forcing teams to be methodical, not giving up a lot of big plays on the year. And they think if you go 12, 13 plays, there's a bigger chance of you making a mistake than us. And that's what happened last series, end up forcing the field goal. But another third and long here for Wasink.
Devon Tucker back in the game at running back. Wasink, 5 of 9, 34 yards through the air. Bringing some heat are the Hilltoppers. Wasink stands in that pocket. Pass is caught around the 35, but that is well shy of the first down. Grooms made the catch. Meadows made the hit.
Playing man coverage, and usually crossing routes are really good versus man coverage if you can separate. No separation at the point of attack there. And Meadows makes a really good tackle in open field, forcing a punt.
Mahalik will punt it away. Pearson back to return it. He stands just inside the 20-yard line. Good kick. That'll hit at the 19. Take a favorable Western Michigan bounce inside the 10 down to around the 7-yard line. A fantastic effort, 57 yards on that one. Well, Tim Lester, the third-year head coach of the Bronco program, trying to get his team fired up before the game. Here's what he had to say.
30 days off. It's a new season, okay? It's a new season, okay? It's a new season to take us into the offseason, make us build this program. It's a new season to send these seniors off with an unbelievable legacy, okay? But understand, okay, it's still going to be about the little things. Leave it all out on the field. Am I clear?
Yes, sir.
Show this country how much you love each other. Get a break. Let's go.
The pregame talk from Coach Lester, who won 6 games in his first year, 7 last year, and trying to push it up to 8 with a win here today against Western Kentucky. Gain of 10 as Lucky Jackson makes the catch. Talking to Coach Lester yesterday, boy, he is a animated, loves to talk football too. Yeah. He was talking about some of the coverages that he faces and what he likes to run against certain things.
Yeah, he was in his element for sure, talking about some of the things they liked and all the different personnel of coaches they had and how they came up with their playbook. I mean, he was locked in, and I was loving every moment of it.
Quick hitter out to Pearson. He'll pick up a couple of yards there on a first down and 10. Make it second and 8 coming up now for this Western Kentucky team.
A since the interception, we've seen they try to get Ty Story some nice, easy completions to get him back into the flow of this ball game. We just saw the sprint out, hit on the outside to Lucky. Now a nice, easy inside screen. Then you start working up to throwing the football down the field. But this is a guy who's played a lot of football. Talked about him being at Arkansas, and now he's playing here for Western Kentucky. He won't be fazed by the interception early.
Came in leading Conference USA in completion percentage at just over 70%. Under pressure, dumps it off underneath. Pass is caught out to the 25-yard line, goes Jernigan. Quinn picks up 7, and that'll be the final play of the first 15 minutes. Western Michigan marches at 13 plays, 57 yards, kept up by a 30-yard field goal. They lead the Serpro First Responder Bowl 3-0. Meeting between these two teams. First one occurred way back in 1923. The last meeting, though, 72 years ago, back in 1947. Average salary back then, Shock? $2,850.
Balling.
Gas was 15 cents a gallon.
Man.
Back in 1947.
15 cents? Can't even fathom that right now.
Salary hadn't changed much, though.
Nah.
Still about $28.50, right?
I don't know, Dave. I've seen your car. I've seen your house. I don't think that fits you.
Ty Story hoping he can make some money. The graduate transfer playing his final collegiate game today. And hopes things can, the professional world, will be good for him in the coming weeks and months. He'll stand in his pocket, dump it off underneath. Goes to Gage Walker. Gage, the redshirt junior out of Tampa, Florida. 226 carries coming in. Over 1,000 yards, 8 touchdowns. And he's a guy, coach is just amazed that he stays on the field as much as he does. He rarely comes off.
I mean, when we say never comes off the field, literally never comes off the field. They use him multiple ways. The coach said, I don't know. He just never ever gets tired in a ball game. Long run, short run, he stays in the ball games. Good out of the backfield. That's a really good story about how he got to playing running back.
Gets the handoff here, makes a man miss, and drives his way to the 45. And that's how he got to become a running back. Was actually a defensive back. First time he touched the football as a defensive back a year ago was a pick six against UTEP. First time he touched it as a running back this year after he made the switch was a 68-yard touchdown run in their opening game.
Yeah, you can see his ability to make guys miss in space and also in between the tackles. Only 195 yards, but he is a really tough runner.
Gage coming near side with it, and he'll get it inside the 50. For more on Gage, let's go down to Dawn.
Yeah, you guys were talking about that switch. It didn't even happen until late in spring practice. Offensive coordinator Brian Ellis had recruited Gage back in high school. He was a wing T running back, tailback in high school, so he knew how talented he was. He said Gage was a little hesitant at first, but guys, after a couple games, one of those first touchdowns, he was all in.
Touchdowns usually do it, Dawn, I'm telling you. Yeah. Everybody loves you after that.
21st in the FBS with those 226 carries coming in. 29th in the country in rushing yards.
And the interesting part about it was they put him in an inside drill. Guys know inside drill is not fun.
Going to the outside, that pass caught there by Lucky Jackson. The fifth-year senior came in with 77 catches, now up over 1,000 yards this season at the wide receiver position. How about of the 77 catches coming in, only 2 have been touchdowns, though?
that is really unorthodox. You usually see a guy who catches the football as much as he does to get in the end zone a little bit more. His ability to make people miss as well after the catch, you think he'd get in the end zone a little bit more. And I'm sure he would love to go out in this ball game with a couple touchdowns in his career.
First down and 10. Four-man rush by the Broncos. Dump it off underneath. That'll be another catch by Lucky Jackson, who picks up 4.
And David, another thing to look out for here is they're using a little bit of tempo. They're at the line of scrimmage. They're not trying to go really fast, but they line it up. They try to get a really distinct count of what's going on the defensive side of the ball and try to get the best play call here early.
10th play of this drive for Tyson Helton's offense. Second down and medium. Story underneath again. Lucky Jackson finding some room to run. Gets a block. Turns the corner to the 20. Stutter steps it all the way down to the 17-yard line. A 20-yard pickup. A.J. Thomas pushes him out of bounds.
And this is what you like. You talk about getting him in space and what he can do to make guys miss. Zaire Barnes has him dead to rights, and he makes him miss right open field. And then you see on the outside blocking for him. A couple receivers outside blocking for him as well.
Pressure comes. Story sees it. Underneath again. Pass is caught. This will be a touchdown for the Hilltoppers. Ja'Cora Pearson with his 7th touchdown reception of the year. 17 yards.
He got a little pressure up the middle from Drake Spears. But give Ty Story a lot of credit after that last drive, throwing the interception, coming back out. Pressure from the inside, Drake Spears, and he stands in there and delivers the football for probably an easy touchdown throw that he's had all year. A walk-in touchdown for Pearson.
Very efficient drive for Western Kentucky. Point after is up and good. Ja'Cora Pearson leads the team with 7 touchdown catches and gets one here in the Serve Pro First Responder Bowl.
Pearson walking in right here, and his story, he's excited.
Welcome back to the Serve Pro First Responder Bowl as part of Capital One Bowl Mania. It is an absolutely gorgeous day here in Dallas. Temperatures expected to be in the mid-50s. Sun is out. Had some tough weather the last few days, but cleared up nicely for us here as we come to you from the campus of SMU. Matter of fact, this is a lot better than a year ago when this game was actually canceled after they got it started because of tornadoes and bad weather. But we are playing some football today. Western Kentucky just took the lead on a 17-yard touchdown pass. 7-3 our score, a short kick taken around the 10 by Keith Mixon, the Mississippi State transfer.
The ball is dead on his catch.
Take a look back at our great Clips drive recap. And I'll tell you what, this was a collective effort on a drive that went 11 plays and 93 yards. A lot of guys touched the football, DJ.
A lot of guys, you know, you're right about that. Some short, easy completions for Ty Story to get him going. And you see a lot of yards out to catch, and Pearson finishing it off, walking into the end zone. But like you mentioned, all their playmakers on that particular drive touched the football and made a play with it.
How about Ty Story on that last drive? 8 out of 8, 76 yards, 17-yard touchdown. First two drives for Western Kentucky, 7 plays, 19 yards. That drive went 11 plays and 93
yards.
Please
set the game clock to 10:54, please.
Ty Story's been pretty accurate.
10:54.
Since he's been in the ball game. He has a complete of less than 62% in his games he's played this year, so expect that to continue.
It'll be time now for John Wasink to get it cranked up, the senior out of Grand Rapids, Michigan, who happens to be getting married on January 10th. Incomplete pass, well played there by Western Kentucky. Keith Mixon, the intended receiver. DeCorian Dart read it from the get-go.
Yeah, exactly. He did not wait on the block to come out for Richie. Saw it, attacked it. And that's the aggressive nature you like out of Dart to make a play on the football there. When they had the numbers on the outside to get it blocked up and possibly be a bigger play.
Fifth-year senior, former walk-on. Ended up starting 32 games for the Hilltoppers. Second down and 10. A lot of motion for the Broncos, but they'll go with an inside handoff going to Tucker. He'll pick up a yard, so now it'll be third down and long for the Broncos as they are backed up around the 11-yard line.
penetration is key. They got a lot of stuff going on at the line of scrimmage you mentioned today. Jet sweep coming across, faking the inside zone and handing the football off. But whenever you got penetration from the inside, it shuts everything else down. And they did a good job there, forcing a third long for Wasson here.
Western Kentucky averaging 34 points a game this year, but only put up 14 in their loss to Northern Illinois in the season finale. Stuck on three right now as we're midway, closing in on midway through the second quarter. And Wasink will dump it off underneath. Pass is caught. That'll be a first down for Western Michigan. They go to Tucker, who picks up 11.
Now that's what you get when you get an experienced guy in Wasink. One to throw the football down the field, one to push it down the field and try to get that first down, but just drops it down on a check down to Tucker, and he does the rest to pick up a first down there on third and long.
Clay Davis, the injured Hilltopper, being helped off the field. Looks like he will be okay eventually, as he tells the trainers, "I'm all right."
Sometimes you get a little stinger there. That keeps you out a little second.
Pass to the far side of the field, caught there by Keith Mixon. Doesn't get much. Did he get back to the line of scrimmage? Looks like no gain on the play there for Western Michigan. Keith Mixon, of course, coming over from Mississippi State, a grad transfer out of Birmingham, Alabama.
And right now, the secondary for Western Kentucky wants it a little bit more than Western Michigan, blocking on the outside the receivers. They're fighting off these guys, especially when they're trying to throw these quick little screens on the outside. They're fighting off and getting to the football.
On second down, Wasink. Boy, receiver tripped up. Gio Ricci over there. Looks like I couldn't tell if he tripped on a Hilltopper foot or he just stumbled out of his break.
Yeah, I think he tripped over the foot of Sky Moore as Meadows was pressing Sky Moore on the outside and pushes him right into Ricci. And sometimes you fall right into a good play if you're Western Kentucky.
Unfortunate for the Broncos. That'll set up third down and 9. Hilltoppers bringing 6. Wasink feels it, flushed out of the pocket, nowhere to go, and he is dropped around the 22, but a flag is down in the backfield. That'll be a loss of 2.
As we know, in that area, usually it's holding of some sort as he tried to get outside and create something on the outside of the pocket. But give Western Kentucky a lot of credit, too. Again, on the outside, nothing there, nowhere for him to go with the football.
Holding. Offense. Number 76. That penalty is declined. Fourth down.
Jalen Moore, your left tackle, is going to get called for the holding call. You get bulldozer like that sometimes. You just want to hang on. That's kind of the case there for Jalen Moore. 6'5", 315. Sometimes that weight gets going the other way and just a good bull rush.
Mahalik back to punt. The flags come in as Mahalik is down on the turf as he got lit up.
Personal foul. Roughing the kicker. Receiving team, number 29, 15 yards, first down.
Deanie Bishop just went full speed right into Mahalik.
Yeah, they always teach these guys, when you're blocking a punt, go at an angle. Don't go at the punter. He catches him as he goes by, and you see the helicopter style he gets caught with there. And unfortunate for Western Kentucky is they had a really good defensive series there. They had to come right back on the field. And maybe this is what this Western Michigan offense needed as they stalled a little bit here early in the second quarter.
That'll set up the Broncos out over the 35 to the 38-yard line. They'll run out of the pistol formation. Levante Bellamy in the backfield. Levante trying to get cranked up a little bit. 6 carries, 13 yards. They'll hand it to him here. And, again, no room to run up front against this Western Kentucky defense that has been pretty stout here this afternoon.
And they have been the more attacking defense in this ball game. And for Western Michigan, Tim Lester talked about them wanting to be an attacking style offense. Well, Western Kentucky is taking the fight to Western Michigan right now.
Four-man front for the Hilltoppers. Fake it to Bellamy. Good play fake. Creates a little space, and that's an incomplete pass. He was trying to hit Sky Moore with it and let him right out of bounds.
This ball has to get out a little bit sooner to give him time to get his feet down on the sideline. The ball comes out just a tad bit late on that slight roll.
Ruin on the field.
Sky Moore unable to get his feet down.
Well, the ruling on the field is incomplete. I think there was anything there to overturn that call.
Yeah, when it's that close, 9 times out of 10, you're going to just keep what's called on the field as they do.
Wasink, 8 out of 15, 50 yards. Little throw to here. That was a little bit behind his intended target, Jalen Hall.
Wasink's just having a tough time seeing the field now. That ball was behind him, but he had Ricci running down the left sideline, wide open. Nobody within 10, 15 yards on him. He throws it to him out in the flat. He picks up that first down easily. And you're going to get a lot of communication on the sideline now from Tim Lester about just seeing the entire field, not locking in on one guy.
Mahalik back on the field after he was roughed up on the last punt attempt just a few moments ago. Good clean snap, end over end, knuckleball. Fielded there by Sloan. And Western Kentucky will have it after the 37-yard punt. Back to Dallas, Texas after this.
Pro First Responder Bowl, brought to you by 1-800-SERV-PRO. Helping make fire and water damage like it never even happened. And Pizza Hut, official pizza of college football. No one out-pizzas the Hut.
Big Red, the huge, furry, lovable creature, originally designed and built by Western Kentucky student Ralph Carey back in 1980. Made its debut during the Hilltopper 79-80 basketball season. He's become a big hit with the fans. People know him around the country as well, old Big Red.
He is a flurry blob. That's the best description I've heard of a mascot in a long time.
I've heard that in my personal life quite a bit. So
never heard
Big Red and I should hang out. Ty Story. First play of this drive, a quick hitter to the outside to Lucky Jackson, picks up 5. After that last drive by Western Kentucky, went 11 plays and 93 yards. Their touchdown drive to give them this 7-3 lead over Western Michigan.
Yeah, we talked to offensive coordinator Brian Ellis. He said the number one thing we must do is execute, which they did on their last drive. We talked about a lot of different guys touching the football. Execute when your play or your time is called.
Ty Story certainly heated up, 11 out of 14. After an opening interception to start this game offensively for the Hilltoppers. Gain of 2 there by Story, who has carried the ball over 100 times this year.
That's something we asked him about, and he said it's something that he didn't really know coming in that he would be asked to do, but he has had the opportunity to do so and has been kind of effective, and it keeps a defense kind of on his toes because they have to respect the run of the quarterback and account for all 11 guys on the field.
Story stands in the pocket, throws, passes caught to the tight end, the young man they love, Joshua Simon. 6'5", 235, the true freshman. They think this guy is going to be a superstar.
And he will, and he is looks like a receiver right now, but they'll get a couple more pounds on this guy and get him going. But I love the eyes of Ty Story going through his progressions. And zone coverage, settles in the pocket, and just delivers a strike right over the middle of Simon for a converted first down.
Story looking to throw, scans the field, now flushed. lofts it up high in the air. Askin has got to make a play. It's incomplete. Trying to hit Sloan. Jacquez was down there. Just couldn't run under it.
This is pretty impressive by Ty Story. Rolling to his left, being able to throw this football and give his guy Sloan an opportunity to almost come down with this football. But it just shows you, these guys continue to settle into this ball game and being more confident throwing the football, giving his guys an opportunity to have a huge big play there, but just out of the reach.
Jackson goes in motion. Go underneath with it to Lucky Jackson. He'll get it into Western Michigan territory after a pickup of four. Drake Spears, the first one there for the Broncos.
And when I started to watch this Western Kentucky offense, the one thing that comes to mind is it's a controlled pass game. They want to stretch the field, but most importantly, the ball wants to come out of the hands of Ty Stewart quickly into the hands of these playmakers that we've seen already. And it's a little bit longer third down than they wanted, but Story's been really confident today throwing the ball on third down.
Has an opportunity here on third down. Quick hitter, Lucky Jackson, first down to the 37-yard line. That'll move the chains. Boy, we see that a lot. You just talked about it. These quick hitters, these quick slants, underneath routes, that's what this offense is based on.
Yeah, it's not rocket science. Corners playing off. Lucky Jackson is an experienced receiver, knows where the void is in the zone coverage, sits down right there, turns around, gets vertical, and picks up the first down.
Led Conference USA in receptions. Lucky today, 8 catches on 9 targets. All day to throw for Story. Probably the most time he's had all day and can't convert.
Yeah, that's the one that's going to hurt because you get exactly what you want. Again, an off corner, one of your better receivers running a comeback on the outside, and the ball is a little bit outside of him. This ball, he has to put on Lucky Jackson. Lucky Jackson stumble coming out of it just a tad, but this is a throw that I expect Ty Story to make.
Second down and 10. 11 of 13 since that 2 out of 5 start for Ty Story. Pass is caught. Sloan. Again inside the red zone. Pushed out of bounds at the 16, a 21-yard pickup. And the Hilltoppers moving now.
Yeah, Western Michigan's got to change up the plan now. They're playing so much zone coverage, so much off coverage on the outside. And Ty Story is just taking what they're giving him and not trying to force it into any particular coverage. But Western Michigan has changed their scope to this ball game right now, playing a little bit tighter coverage on the outside.
Defensive coordinator Lou Esposito trying to come up with some answers here as the Hilltoppers driving again. Another quick throw. Pearson. He's wrapped up for no gain. Ken Aguirre, one of those defensive linemen making the play, 290-pounder.
And that's what you need, especially on those little small inside screens. The ability to turn and run from your defensive lineman helps because that's where all the pressure is coming from. And him trying to go back to the middle of the field with that play forces no gain.
10th play of this drive. Second down and 10. They will hand it off to Gage Walker. Cuts it upfield, gets it inside the 10, down to the 9. It'll be a 7-yard gain.
This is a critical point here as the second quarter gets down. You got to hold the 3 points here. You don't want to go up into halftime being down 14-3. You got to try to force a field goal here. Maybe you bring some pressure. You haven't brought a lot of pressure but one time on the last touchdown. But the zone has not really benefited you here.
Story on a quarterback keeper. Needed 3, but I don't think he got but a couple of yards on that little keeper. Ralph Holly led the charge up front. The nose tackle for the Broncos. So now it's 4th down and about a yard, and Tyson Helton brings out his field goal kicking unit.
Outstanding stop by Western Michigan there to get a stop up front. Rob Holly up front, getting the penetration, forcing his field goal. But they went up and down the field there.
Corey Munson, the true freshman out of Warner Robins, Georgia, 14 out of 24 on the year. 8 out of 9 inside 30 yards. This will be from 26. His right-footed kick is on the way, and it is hammered through the uprights. So that drive caps off with three. Hilltoppers will take the three. Western Michigan will take it. They get the stop, and we'll get the football down a touchdown. Tomorrow we'll have three more bowl games for you on ESPN and, of course, the ESPN app. Virginia Tech's longtime defensive coordinator Bud Foster faces a tough test in his final game when the Hokies square off against Kentucky in the Belt Bowl at noon Eastern. Then it's number 23 Navy taking on Kansas State in the AutoZone Liberty Bowl from Memphis. And at 7:30 Eastern, we'll have the Valero Alamo Bowl between number 11 Utah and the Texas Longhorns. Now it's time to take a look at the Bowl Challenge Cup standings brought to you by Progressive. SEC off to a good start at 2-0. Big Ten's only loss was Ohio State against Clemson. What a game that was. Big 12 trying to find a victory somewhere in there. They'll have some opportunities coming up the next few days. Here's a return by Keith Mixon, and he's out over the 30 to the 33-yard line. We got to step aside for a moment. Broncos try to get this offense going. We'll find out if they can when we come back. Not a touchdown late second quarter from Dallas, Texas on the campus of SMU. Dave Neal, DJ Shockley, Don Davenport down on the sidelines, and that guy, Levante Bellamy, they need to get him going. He was the MAC Offensive Player of the Year, almost over 1,400 yards rushing, 23 touchdown rushes this year, but it has been a relatively quiet day for Mr. Bellamy. 7 carries, just 14 yards.
Yeah, he scored 138 points this year. He's a big part of what they do. 9 touchdown runs of over 20-plus yards, so they would love for him to knock off one of those huge runs here on this drive.
3,600 yards in his career, 5th at Western Michigan, his 35 rushing touchdowns, 4th at Western Michigan. Wasink will throw here underneath route. Pass is caught. That'll be close to midfield. Sky Moore again stepping up. They're a true freshman with another catch today.
Good job of Watson going through his progressions, looking downfield, going through his second, third, into his fourth progression on that and delivering a strike for a good play on first down.
Throw it again here. Wasink high, and it's picked off. A little bit late. Tried to hit Ricci, the tight end, and that one is scooped up by Kyle Bailey.
Kyle Bailey in the hip pocket of Ricci. Not to mention the ball is behind him, and there's no separation by Ricci on his out route. And when you throw the football behind him, that's what's usually going to happen. He's going to come up with a big-time play, and what a momentum-changing play here right before the half as Western Kentucky defense comes up with a huge play.
Former safety, moved to linebacker this year, had 2 interceptions against UAB this year. Just picked up his 3rd interception. Boy, Wasink would love to have that one back.
Oh, man. Yeah, I mean, that's exactly what you draw up. One of your big-time players matched up man-to-man, and you just don't deliver.
So with a 10-3 lead, Western Kentucky completes the pass to Simon. I'm going to say incomplete, so it'll be second down and 10.
Usually you see after turnover, a team usually takes a shot down the field to give yourself a chance here. And with a minute 46 to go before halftime, expect to see them try to push this football down the field.
Story keeps it himself. He's out to the 47. It'll be third down and about 3.5, maybe 4. Coming up for Western Kentucky as they will take a timeout. Stops the clock with a minute 30.
Timeout. Western Kentucky, their first charge timeout will be a 30-second timeout. Please set the game clock to 140. 140, please.
They'll push the clock back to a minute 40 now. It gives us an opportunity to tell you about this year's recipients of the ROTC Senior of the Year Award presented by Navy Federal Credit Union. Charles Bloom of NC State, Nicole Butler of Notre Dame, and Jennifer Philibrown of Florida. Now, this award spans the entire country and all branches of the ROTC. It celebrates the students who embody leadership, military excellence, scholarships, community service. I just want you to look at their resumes for these kids. This is incredible.
Unreal.
You would never see that under my name. I can promise you that.
Astronaut, a doctor in the Army, Marine, man. I don't know. I'm afraid of heights, so I don't know if I could be a pilot. Maybe become a doctor in the Army would be pretty cool.
Double major in Arabic and biochemistry.
What'd you say?
Yeah, exactly. Those are some impressive students right there.
Absolutely.
Third down coming up for Western Kentucky. Pass is caught, easily done there by Lucky Jackson. How does he get so wide? I mean, he has created so much space.
I mean, there's no doubt on a key situation, they're going to Lucky on the outside. And his ability to create that separation and make every route look the same, reuses leverage really well when he runs this route, and he comes out of the break really fast to create that separation. Lucky is, we mentioned it in the open, a very top-notch receiver.
Story. Going to run with it, trying to get out of bounds. He'll do so after picking up a couple of yards. Lupro pushes him out of bounds. That'll stop the clock with a minute 29 to go before halftime. Lowest scoring half. This is the 10th edition of this bowl game. The lowest scoring first half in the bowl's history is 14 points. UNLV and North Texas were tied at 7 back in 2014. That was a game on January 1st of the 2013 season.
Very nice nugget there, Dave. Very nice.
Second down and we'll call it about 8. Wide open, sitting down is Joshua Simon, the tight end inside the 25.
And Joshua. Simon again, I mean, you're talking about, we talked about him earlier, and that's one of those things that's been there all day for him because they're playing so much zone coverage, and this young guy in Simon understanding where to sit down in the zone, where to place himself, and moves away from coverage to make it easier for Story.
Played high school quarterback as a senior a year ago. That handoff goes to Gage Walker. He's inside the 15. There'll be a timeout there. Pick up a 7.
Timeout. Western Kentucky. Their second charge timeout. 30-second timeout.
Coming up on the Mercedes-Benz Halftime Report, Reese Davis, David Pollack, Desmond Howard be live from the Rose Bowl. National Championship game preview. Amongst many other topics, and boy, what a game that will be. Clemson, LSU, cannot wait. Mm. And that game will be Monday, January 13th at 8 o'clock Eastern, 5 Pacific, right here on ESPN. And, of course, the ESPN app. We'll have the college football playoff national championship game presented by AT&T from Mercedes-Benz Superdome in New Orleans. Joe Burrow, Trevor Lawrence. Both teams, very impressive. I love the comeback from Clemson. When they looked in disarray in the first half, this guy at no point was
in disarray.
Are you
sure this is not a typo here? I mean, unreal watching that ball game. 7 pass touchdowns in that game. He ran for another one in the game as well. But his ability to just carve up offenses, carve up defenses every single week is fun to watch unless you're the opposing defense.
Story will throw. That one is picked off. It was batted in the air. This could be trouble for Western Kentucky. Kareem Ali to the house. Touchdown, Broncos. 85 yards.
What a change of momentum here at the end of this half. The reflection ball coming off the and then running all the way back. I mean, that's big-time football for Western Michigan. They needed something good to happen to them there. And Ali comes up with a huge, huge play. Ball pops off the receiver's hands here, and Kareem Ali just being in the right spot at the right time to run this football back. And Ty Storr giving his best opportunity trying to get him down on the ground, but a lot of speed by Ali to finish that thing off and change the momentum here for Western Michigan.
Point after to try to tie this one up, and it is good. Under a minute to play, and Western Michigan needed a break to go their way, and they got it on the tapped ball. The tight end, Simon, popped it up in the air, and Kareem Ali, the grad transfer from Temple, takes it the distance, and the turnover belt
is alive. We talked to Hayward about the turnover belt, and he said Esposito, the defensive coordinator, loves the turnover belt. And as you can see, the fans here from Western Michigan love the turnover belt as well. Huge, huge turn of events here for them.
Big Lou loving it. His defense have been on the field quite a bit here in the last quarter and change. Lengthy drives by Western Kentucky, but took the deflection. And the old pick six ties this one up.
And it looks like Western Kentucky has been going up and down the field, controlling this ball game. But as they got into the red zone, it was almost bend but not breaking. They've come up with some stops, forced some field goals, and now they get the big turnover. It's probably the key to this ball game right now, the defense of Western Michigan not allowing Western Kentucky to get points at the end.
Second interception today for Ty Story. Unfortunate, that goes on his ledger. Doing what his fault.
I used to hate those, Dave. You know, I used to be like, well, why is it the count against the quarterback? I mean, we put it where it should have been called.
Hilltoppers with one timeout. And that one will go out of bounds as well, so the Hilltoppers will get it at the 35-yard line.
Free kick out of bounds. Kicking team, number 39. Ball will be placed at the 35-yard line.
Ty Story, 18 of 25 with a touchdown and now two picks. And those picks are certainly important today, especially when you consider what he's done the last three games. He went 92 attempts without an interception. But in 25 attempts today, he's thrown two picks.
I'll be interested to see what they do here with 59 seconds to go. I think it all depends on this first play, how successful it is.
Looks pretty successful here with Gage Walker picking up the first down near the 49-yard line and an injured Bronco back around the 32. That'll stop the clock for an injury timeout at 53 seconds. That's Ralph Holly, the big defensive tackle, the 285-pound junior.
You don't ever see anybody go down with an injury, but this helps Western Kentucky. They don't have to burn that last timeout they have and continue to start driving this football down to keep that timeout and try to get in the field goal range here under a minute to go.
Ralph Holly's a guy that's played since a true freshman year, the junior. 32 stops on the year. Four sacks. Coach telling us that he's just an explosive guy for a size. Really quick at 6'2", 285. Good to see him pop up, shake it off. I love seeing the big guys wearing these single digits.
Just stretches out a little bit. Lined up right over Jordan Merritt, 61, the right guard. It's a lot of friendly fire when you're in the trenches down there. You get caught up, feet get tangled up, and guys land on you sometimes. So price you got to pay down there playing as a big guy.
The clock will start right now. So Western Kentucky with one timeout near midfield. They'll hand it off again to Gage Walker. This time he's got nowhere to go. Use one of those timeouts right here. I guess you got to, and that's what Western Kentucky will do. Drake Spears with his fifth tackle for the Broncos with 47 seconds to go before halftime.
The third and final timeout, 30 seconds timeout.
Give us a chance to tell you that on New Year's Day on ESPN and, of course, the ESPN app. It is the granddaddy of them all. Sixth-ranked Oregon takes on eighth-ranked Wisconsin in the Rose Bowl, presented by Northwestern Mutual and number 5 Georgia, number 7 Baylor meet in the All-State Sugar Bowl. And shocked, they may be calling you to see if you've got a jersey. Georgia's going to be missing a ton of players, including a handful of offensive linemen. I know Harrion, the running back's not going to play in this one. It's kind of a mess here the last few weeks for the Bulldogs.
Yeah, the guy I'm worried about is the guy on the promo right there, Jake Fromm. Not sure if anybody's going to be blocking for him up front. Charlie Brewer and that Baylor team played pretty good.
Let's take a look at what's in store this postseason, brought to you by Macy's, and you see what's coming up on New Year's Day. How about this? All those games, those eight teams, all in the top 18. That Minnesota-Auburn game should be a lot of fun, a lot of fireworks offensively.
Looking to continue to roll the boat there, Minnesota.
Here's Story. He'll dump it off to Lucky Jackson underneath. He'll get it out to the 45-yard line, shy of the first down. No timeouts left for Western Kentucky after a gain of seven.
Yeah, now you got to look to try to get something to the sideline. You pick up a first down, the clock stops, so it's critical that you do that here on third down.
They'll send Gage Walker in motion underneath route. Pass is caught there by Ja'Core Pearson. That's a first down to stop the clock after a 9-yard pickup. 18 seconds to go.
And now the clock stops. You get an opportunity to line up and try to go again, but you got to go fast here.
Story over the middle. Pass caught by the tight end, Simon. He's down around the 10-yard line. Took a tough hit and held on after a 24-yard pickup.
Yeah, now you got to clock the football. Now you're in field goal range. Clock the football. You got time. No need to rush. Perfectly designed there. A little two-minute drive for Western Kentucky to get in the field goal range. And this is what we talked about all first half. The off coverage, the zone coverage from Western Michigan, giving up these chunk plays. Simon down the middle of that seam, stays away from that safety, and Story delivers a nice strike to him to get him in this position to kick a field goal right before half.
Could Simon be the next NFL tight end for Western Kentucky? Tyler Higbee, Jack Doyle, Deion Yelder, all in the NFL right now from Western Kentucky. Timeout taken by Western Michigan.
Timeout, Western Michigan. First charge timeout of the half. 30-second timeout.
Get Corey Munson, the true freshman, to think about it for just a moment. Well, other than the batted ball by Simon that allowed the pick six return that went 88 yards, this kid has been something else now. Joshua Simon averaging almost 14 yards a catch. He's a true freshman. And, you know, they were telling us yesterday that if it wasn't for the fact that somebody got hurt his senior year in high school,
yeah,
it forced him to play quarterback instead of tight end. And had he been a tight end his senior year, he wouldn't be playing at Western Kentucky.
Yeah, because you see the ability that he has. The big-time schools, everybody talks about the big Power 5 schools that come here. They'll be knocking on his door and trying to get him to go to one of these bigger schools. But I'm sure Western Kentucky is extremely happy they got it. And after the pick six, this is huge right here.
29-yard field goal attempt from Corey Munson. He is hit from 26. Good clean snap. Kick is on the way. And he will miss it. Oh my goodness. That'll be the final play.
Western's first.
All tied up at 10, but Munson misses the chippy. So Munson now on the year, 15 out of 26. Could have used those three in a tie ball game here at the ServPro First Responder Bowl. And let's go down to Dawn Davenport. Dawn?
Yeah, here with Coach Helton. Coach, big change in momentum there after that pick and miss field goal. What's your message going to be to your offense at half?
Well, I think the guys are playing really hard. It's just football, you know, it's unfortunate play, and it's what these bowl games are all about. You just, if you have a bad play, you got to rebound, come right back. We made a great drive there, right, you know, wish we would have made the field goal, but we'll go in there and regroup, and we got a lot of good things going on. We just got to, you know, finish some drives and put points on the board.
Thank you, Coach.
All right, thank you.
All right, all tied up here from Dallas, Texas at the First Responder Bowl. Tied at 10. And that's it for the first 30 minutes of action. Stay tuned for our halftime activities. Reese Davis, David Pollack, and Desmond Howard.
Back to Capital One Bowl Mania.
And welcome back to the ServPro First Responder Bowl as part of Capital One Bowl Mania. Gorgeous day here in Dallas, Texas. Halftime between Western Michigan out of the MAC and Western Kentucky from Conference USA, all tied up at 10. Dave Neal back alongside my partner DJ Shockley, former University of Georgia quarterback. And boy, tell you what, Western Kentucky not only put up a bunch of yards, but they did a number on Western Michigan, slowing them down almost 2.5 yards to 1 in this game. Hilltoppers out in front.
Yeah, I think it comes down to Wasink in this ball game. He hasn't really played his style of football. He struggled in his last two outings. They need him to play better offensively. They're 3 of 8 on third down. Western Michigan has to get something going offensively if they want to stay in this ball game. The only 10 points have come off the turnovers from Western Kentucky.
Well, Western Kentucky got off to a slow start, which leads us into our Serve Pro playbook. But then they got it cranked up, and the guy we thought would be a big factor in this one, Lucky Jackson, was huge for them in the first half.
Yeah, Lucky Jackson there. They're finding multiple ways to get him the football, but it's all become because of the coverage that Western Michigan is playing against him. Lots of off coverage versus him, and he's taking it. Then we talked about it earlier in the ball game. His yards after catch has been crucial. You're talking about bringing him across on shallow crosses. Here's another separate way they get him the football, and then he's going to make another play after the catch, making guys miss, getting upfield. And he has been the difference maker for Western Kentucky, and whenever they needed a big-time play, it happens. And again, 7-8 yards off, this is easy. This is pitch and catch. This is 7-on-7 for Ty Story on the outside, and Lucky Jackson's going to make a miss, and he's going to get more of that in the second half.
Ty Story did have 2 interceptions. One of those was an 88-yard pick six. But other than that, Ty Story was pretty efficient. 21 of 28, 216. Jackson with 10 catches on the day. Jackson, again, targeted 12 times, makes 10 grabs. And Simon, the tight end, also got involved there in the second quarter. And he is just a stud as a true freshman at the tight end position. So Western Kentucky will get the football first to start the third quarter. Sloan brings it out over the 20, and he's hit around the 24-yard line. Let's get an update from Dawn Davenport.
Yeah, I spoke with head coach Tim Lester. He said, what do you have to do to get your MAC Offensive Player of the Year, Levante Bellamy, going and that run game going? He said, we've got to be better on first down. He said, we're 2nd and 12, 2nd and 11. He said, time of possession, we did great early on in that half, the first quarter, about 11 minutes, he said, but they kind of turned the tide. They said they have to make better decisions offensively. And that falls on his senior quarterback. He had a conversation with him about those decisions. Pretty happy with what he's seen defensively, but he said they've got to get after Ty Story. He has too much time back there.
Pass is caught around the 29-yard line. That one goes to Quinn Jernigan. Anton Curtis over there to make the play defensively, a gain of 5. And yeah, you know, back to Western Michigan for a moment. I mean, the numbers in the first half for the Broncos offensively with just a struggle, 105 yards of offense. That's the lowest output in a half this year.
Yeah, that's something they got to improve on, especially they're going to be in this ball game late.
Incomplete pass as flags come down. Looks like Western Michigan jumping off sides. A free play. Hilltoppers will have another opportunity.
Offside defense, number 1, 5-yard penalty. Replay, second down.
Ali Fayad, the junior defensive end.
Result of the penalty is a first down.
So first down and 10.
Don't even imagine what they talked about at halftime, especially after the way they finished that first half. This second half is crucial, and I know he talked to a lot of his seniors who had to lead this program and try to get a win here to end this season.
Western Kentucky, 284 yards of offense. Ty Story going to run for it, tripped up. Got to the 40, and there is Fayad, who came in to make the play, just jumped off sides and makes amends with a nice defensive play.
Again, I get a lot of credit to Story there, not forcing the ball into coverage. And sometimes when you call a shot play, it doesn't mean you have to throw it all the way. You have to make that big-time throw. I think he did a good job of tucking the football away and just getting what he can. And now you have everything at your disposal here on second down.
Second down and long 4, short 5. Ty Story gets hit immediately. He never even got his eyes down the field. Balavani came in flying like a missile for a loss of 8.
And you can see the difference now in this second half. Coming right up the middle is Bella Bonnie. And they're not going to allow Ty Story to sit back here and survey the field and be able to throw it all over. They're going to bring pressure. They're going to put some pieces in his face now and force him to get that ball out of his hands even quicker. But you can see the change in what they want to do and what they want to be here in the second half.
Outstanding student is Balabani. Engineering design technology major. Getting a job with Ford next month. Wants to get into automotive engineering. Deep throw. He and Jackson can't connect. And it'll be a punting situation now for the Hilltoppers.
And again, they brought pressure trying to get the football out of his hands. They did a good job of picking it up. But the miscommunication is something we haven't seen out of Jackson and Story from the first half. Miscommunication there as they come out of the second half.
Well, that's exactly what Western Michigan needed, a good defensive stop. And give Keith Mixon an opportunity to return this punt. John Haggerty, another Australian punter. It's a boomer. Mixon backpedals all the way down to the 17-yard line, and he is hit there. Flags come out as well. This will be a win for Western Kentucky. Haggerty came in averaging over 46 yards a punt. That is a Western Kentucky single-season average record. And that one went 48.
During the return, illegal block in the back. Number 24, the penalty would be half the distance to the goal. First down.
So that'll back the Broncos up right around the 10-yard line. And Levante Bellamy has got to get it going somehow, some way. Averaging almost 118 yards a game rushing on almost 21 carries per game. But you see the numbers there, 7 for 14 today.
And coming to this ball game, he talked about, I don't care if they got 7-8 guys in the box, I still should be able to run versus any defense. And if they're going to get going, he has to be a huge part of what they do.
Wasink going deep. This one is incomplete. Underthrew his intended target. Deshaun Bussell, coverage there by Trey Meadows.
Bussell had a step on him. And Watson just could not get the football out of it. That's a long throw, trying to slight roll to the left and trying to get that football out. But good job of Meadows not running into the receiver there and not forcing a pass interference there, being cautious after that deep ball.
Wasink throws a quick slant, pass caught. Sky Moore out over the 40 to the 42-yard line. A big gainer there for the Broncos to get him out of the shadows of the goalposts after 34 yards.
And even though Bellamy hasn't run the football effective, they still want to stop the run. You have 8 guys in the box with no safety in the middle of the field, and that leaves a huge void for Sky Moore on the outside on Ruffin, to make that big-time catch.
They'll go handoff with Levante Bellamy trying to stretch it near side and nowhere to run. Only gets a yard on the play. Some more football coming your way today here on ESPN. Mississippi State, Louisville from the Music City Bowl, the Franklin American Mortgage Music City Bowl from Nashville, Tennessee. And then later on tonight, it's the Orange Bowl, Florida and Virginia. Boy, Dan Mullen. As that Gator program certainly trending in the right direction. Another stout defensive effort from the Gators.
Yeah, Trask has played really well for the Gators this year, stepping in for Felipe Franks, getting that team to the Orange Bowl. Not many people knew the Trask story coming into this year, and he has excelled at the quarterback position for the Gators, looking to finish off this season later on tonight versus Virginia.
Two teams that love to get to the quarterback. Florida fifth in the country in sacks. Virginia sixth. That'll be coming up tonight. Right now, though, Western Michigan trying to keep this drive alive on a third down and 6. Ball sits at the 45-yard line. quick slant over the middle to the tight end, Ricci, and he is cut down at the Hilltopper 49, and that'll be short of the line to gain. So now you're looking at about fourth and a yard and a half, and Tim Lester wastes no time in making the decision to go for it.
Yeah, it's a bowl game. The offense hasn't really done a lot today. Maybe this gives him the kickstart and confidence if they are able to pick this up, that he's not afraid, and now he's trying to pay it off by his offense, leaving them on the field.
Handoff goes to Bellamy. He has the first down and then some to the 43-yard line. Gain of 7.
And there's that extra effort that we talked about with Bellamy. His ability to make some guys miss, and he was so close to taking this the distance. He was able to come out of that last tackle, but the vision to get through that first hole and then to run through the arm tackles, that was pretty impressive.
First down and 10, Broncos. Four-man rush by the Hilltoppers. Wasink sees a little bit of room up the middle, will take it himself. He's to the 30 and has another first down at the 29. Give him 13 yards. Juwan Jones chases him down.
Yeah, Western Kentucky playing coverage. Western Michigan tries to run four verticals, so everybody's down the field. Nobody underneath. He takes it into his own rights and runs to pick up a huge first down. You love the play call, but even love the decision by Wasink.
Looks like Sky Moore wants to throw it back to his quarterback, Wasink, and it's in the air and incomplete. That ball hung up in the air just a little too long, allowing Western Kentucky an opportunity to make a play, but there is a flag down right where Sky Moore threw the football.
Oh, yeah, it's going to be roughing the passer on that one.
Juwan Jones was back there.
Personal foul. Roughing the passer. Defense, number 34. A penalty half the distance to the goal. First down, Western Michigan.
I love the play call here. A little razzle-dazzle. This is something that Western Michigan does a lot of. A lot of trick plays throughout the year. And as he's about to throw that football, coming from way from the other side with a running start, he lets that football go. A little extra there at the end, but I love the hops there of Wasink. Almost coming down with that football. He'd have caught that. That would have been pretty cool.
Well, instead, they'll take the penalty and march him to the 15-yard line. Hand it off to Levante Bellamy. Cuts it back inside the 10, down to the 8-yard line. That's a gain of 7. Western Michigan inside the red zone. This year is converting at 79%, not a great number. That is 8th in the MAC, 92nd in the country. Hand it off to Bellamy, and he'll get it down to the 7-yard line. Gain of 2.
We talked to Jake Moreland, offensive coordinator for Western Michigan, and asked him some of the keys to this ball game. He said, number one thing we have to do is finish drives, finish series. Here is a big-time drive here that they need to finish and put 6 on the board.
There's the offensive coordinator, Jake Moreland, from the 6-yard line. See what he dials up on a 2 tight end set. He'll throw it. Quick slant. Touchdown, Broncos. That one goes to Deshaun Bussell.
Love the play design. Love how an offense calls it a defense will call it a pick, but it is a really good play coming from the outside in and running a little underneath, shallow, cut underneath, and it's a good job of running his actual route. Coming underneath, and you're going to see him come and outside, and here comes inside to get into the end zone for the big touchdown.
For Bussell, his second touchdown catch of the year. Young man who missed all of last season with an injury. Picks up 6 here. Nice drive from Western Michigan. 10 plays, 90 yards. Capped off by the Bussell 6-yard touchdown reception. 17-10 Broncos.
Kentucky and their quarterback, Ty Story, today has had an up-and-down day with his play, and it started early in the ball game with an interception. And you're talking about being a guy who hasn't thrown a lot of interceptions this season, but today he has struggled some. But then he started to settle in and make some plays, get the football to some of his playmakers on the outside, allow them to make some plays down the field. And then right before the half, he was had a deflection there that took him all the way down, and been an up and down game for Ty Story.
Mostly ups, though, for Ty Story. He'll have a chance here as the Hilltoppers will have the football as Sloan is wrapped up. He'll spot his forward progress back at the 20. But Ty Story, there is a flag down. Right on the ServPro logo on the far side of the field, away from where the return came. So our referee today, Jeremy Parker, has to 30-yard jog. Our officiating crew out of the Sun Belt Conference.
Personal foul, block below the waist, on the return team, number 17, we have to distance to the goal, first down.
So that'll back the Hilltoppers up. But Ty Story today is 22 out of 30, 221. Saw those picks, and really the one that was the 88-yard pick six return for a touchdown. Really wasn't his ball. Wasn't a bad throw. His receiver just batted it in the air and allowed the Broncos to come up with the clean interception in the return. So a two tight end set, and they'll hand it off. There's Gage Walker. He's out near midfield. A good start to the drive for the Hilltoppers. A gain of 39.
Gage with the ability to hit it and get north and south. He doesn't play when he gets inside the hole a lot of times. And then he has the ability to break tackles. Only 195 yards, but he runs behind his pad, runs tough. And you can see the speed at the end of that run to pick up even more yards. And that's what helps a quarterback, too, is having a good run game. And Ty Story has been really good in the run game himself, but having Gage a part of it really helped his offense.
They'll fake it to Gage. They will throw it to the tight end, Joshua Simon. Gain of three. But, you know, Gage Walker, we talked about him as the running back. You know, he redshirted in 2016, did not play in 17, was a defensive back in 18, and in the spring decided to make him a running back. They just needed some bodies. I mean, they didn't have anybody.
Yeah, and he was a guy that came in, and they put him in an inside drill. If anybody understands the inside drill, it's only where you have linemen and linebackers, and this is your first time coming in college playing running back. That's probably one of the tougher moments to come in, and he came in and made a couple cuts, and they knew he was going to be good to go from there.
Finished up second in Conference USA in rushing. Here's Lucky Jackson. Nice stiff arm, makes the man miss and gets it close to the 40-yard line. And that should be good enough for the first down as he picks up nine.
And this is just pitch and catch on the outside. You got off coverage again. We talked about it as we started the second half. Whenever Lucky Jackson is getting some off coverage, they find a way to get him the football. And now you can see they're starting to play a little bit tighter on the outside versus him because they have just given him easy catches.
Story. Boy, dancing around. Hit as he throws. It's incomplete as he's dropped to the turf. Timothy Collins came in. Transfer, grad transfer out of Tennessee Tech, laying the hit on Ty Story.
Story moving pretty good inside the pocket, trying to find somewhere to throw the football. And eventually that defensive line gets home and gets the pressure on him. And he wanted to throw a comeback to the outside again to Lucky Jackson, but they did a good job of running the linebacker out underneath him so he couldn't throw it and had to get off of it and go somewhere else.
Pressure comes. Story feels it, throws underneath. It's incomplete. Boy, it did not take long for the Bronco rush to get right on top of Ty Story. That pressure came from Ali Fayad.
Yeah, you bring Hayward off the other side and you have pressure come from the middle of your offensive line, and that forces him out to the right side, and that's been kind of the the go-to blitz for him in his second half is bringing pressure up the middle, forcing him outside the pocket.
So now it's third down and 10 from the 39.5-yard line. Hilltoppers 5 out of 9 on third downs.
And you see him trying to mess with the protection calls up front. Look at the guys just walking around. Only two guys with the hand on the ground.
Story will keep it himself, and that's not going to get nearly enough. Give him 3 yards when he needed 10. There is a flag down around the 30-yard line.
After the play, unsportsmanlike conduct on the offense. Number two, that will be a 15-yard penalty. It will be fourth down.
Jaquez Sloan, the junior receiver out of Atlanta.
That is number two's first unsportsmanlike conduct foul.
Good job, Western Michigan bowing their necks there. West Kentucky had a few things going on that drive, completed a couple passes, but ultimately came down to the pressure they put on Ty Story in that second down call to force that long third down play.
Well, they were going to have the football around the 35. I don't know that you would have necessarily attempted a 52-yard field goal into the wind from there, but now you force the issue, and it's definitely a punt situation. So Haggerty is back to punt for the Hilltoppers. Keith Mixon back at the 10-yard line. Play clock under 5. Wobbly kick. Mixon says, get away from it. It's going to hit and bounce, and he will scoop it up around the 8. And he'll be taken out of bounds just across the 10-yard line, a 44-yard punt. So the Broncos leading it by a touchdown over the Hilltoppers. Back to Dallas in a moment.
The Serve Pro First Responder Bowl, brought to you by Las Vegas. The NFL Draft comes to Las Vegas in April 2020. And Capital One, what's in your wallet?
Boy, what a night of football. College football playoff semifinal. A couple of nights ago, what a game between Clemson and Ohio State. Looked like the Buckeyes had that one wrapped up. Some controversial calls, non-calls, if you will. Stirred the pot a little bit, but at the end, it was Clemson taking down Ohio State 29-23. And what can you say about LSU and the season they've had? 63 points on the Sooners to win that one, 63-28.
Looking more complete as they go, Dave. Especially on defense.
Wassing, long throw, and that one is dropped around the 22-yard line. So it'll be second down and 10 coming up for Western Michigan. I mean, I've been doing this a long time, over 20 years. I can't remember. And there have been some good quarterbacks, don't get me wrong. But what Joe Burrow has done and the plays he's created and the throws he's made, this is one of the most special seasons I've seen from a quarterback.
He's got some really good receivers. His offensive line is good. But Joe Burrow, his ability to get that football out into, and he throws it into some tough windows, too.
Bat in the air, almost picked off. It'll fall harmlessly to the turf, and Western Michigan will get another crack at it on third down.
Almost a lucky break here for Western Kentucky as that ball is bounced around. Antoine Kincaid close to it. And that's the one you see in your sleep at night. You're like, you can see it, the football. Everything is in slow motion. You just can't come down with it. But still, they're in a good spot right here, forcing Western Michigan to be in the third long.
Devon Tucker in the backfield alongside Wasink. Wasink under pressure. Stays on his feet to the 15, flips in the air to the 18, and he'll be shy of the line again, which is at the 21. A 7-yard pickup for the senior quarterback who just took a shot.
Giving up his body, trying to pick up a first down.
Their offense has struggled throughout the ball game, but I love the effort. The effort to try to get this first down and knowing he's going to take a shot here. Nothing else to do. He has to leave everything on the line here in this ball game. And I think, if anything, that's going to motivate the guys on the offensive side, knowing their quarterback has given up their body to try to pick up a first down.
Not much on the return from Clayton Bush. 45-yard punt. Two types of Tigers, all with one goal, the national championship. Inside the college football playoff, now streaming on ESPN+. Go behind the scenes of the college football playoff semifinals and see how it all goes down. National championship game, January 13th. From Mercedes-Benz Superdome down on the bayou in New Orleans, Louisiana.
You think they have a little home field advantage there? Maybe just slightly?
Clemson will travel now. They'll find a way. Trust me, they'll find a way to light it up with some orange. Deep down the middle, pass is incomplete. Looked like Pearson might have been grabbed as he tried to turn back for the football.
I think you're right, Dave. He definitely got away with a grab here as Pearson trying to fight back to get to the football and yanks him as he's coming back. That's one of those that you look back and say that should have been a definite PI call, trying to fight back for the football, not allowing him to get back.
Empty set for the Hilltoppers. Story underneath throw to Lucky Jackson. He spins it back. Only a few yards on the play, gain of three. Lucky, though, continues to add to his reception total. He's up over 100 yards. A dozen catches today for Lucky.
Here's a spot here where Lucky has lived all day long on third down. And it'll be interesting to see how Western Michigan plays. The last few times they brought pressure, but now you see there's tighter coverage on the outside against Lucky on this particular play, and now they get him playing inside. Now you got the leverage you want.
Story buying some time, throws, and is that one caught? They're going to say yes, it is, around the 43. That was Lucky Jackson again, who just broke the bowl record for number of catches. That is his 13th of the day. And they're going to be shy of the first down by about a yard. Offense stays on the field on a fourth down and a yard.
And he brought in another lineman as well.
Two tight end set. Story takes it himself off the right side. Did he make it? They're going to spot it. I think they're going to give him it. Ooh. If the ball's touching the 44, it should be a first down.
It's going to be tough. They bring in an extra lineman, pull the backside guard to try to get even extra momentum going forward, end up giving him the first down. But give Ty Story a lot of credit at sticking his hand in there. Both quarterbacks trying to give up their body here in their last ball game to get the first down. But you love the fact Ty Story downhill, didn't waste any extra movement, and just sticks his head down to get that first down.
Boy, ran right into Trey Hayward, the MAC Defensive Player of the Year. And got just enough.
Ruling on the field is a first down. The previous play is under further review.
I'm going to check that spot. And it is a big check, to say the least. Getting late in the third quarter, 2:56 to play. Crucial decision coming up on the other side. Did Story get the first down, or will Western Michigan have the football? We'll tell you when we come back. Big call coming up here on a fourth down and about a yard and a half. Ty Story keeps it off the right side. And does his knee go down? It's just, to me, it's hard to tell.
After further review, the runner was short of the line to gain. The ball will be placed at the 43-and-a-half yard line. It will be first down, Western Michigan.
Well, I tell you, I'm going to stick with my story here. I don't know. It's hard to tell if that knee hit the ground. I just don't know that you can – definitively say that that's indisputable video evidence.
Dave, I'm telling you, I got 20/20. I could see it on there. I think his knee was down right there. I understand what you're saying, but from that view we got there, looks like that knee was down.
Well, Tyson Helton would love an explanation as well.
Tyson's with you. There's no definitive answer, he's saying.
Yeah. I'm not saying the knee didn't go down. I'm just saying from that replay, it is hard to overturn that call. Just my perspective.
I'm with you.
Well, that's a big play in this game. That gives Western Michigan the football in Western Kentucky territory at the 43-yard line. With 3:07 to go, third quarter. First shot. Down and 10 for the Broncos. Yeah, maybe take a shot right here. A little shoulder fake. They will come near side looking for the tight end, Ricci, and he went up high to get it. Antoine Kincaid came over there to force the incomplete pass.
I love the play call, trying to fake the bubble screen on the outside to mix it and get Ricci, your big tight end, running down the sideline. But Western Kentucky did a really good job of staying at home on the backside and getting their fifth pass breakup of the ball game.
Second down and 10. Handoff goes to Tucker. Boy, he is met at the 40 and driven back a yard, but he'll pick up three with his forward progress. Kyle Bailey in there to make the stop along with Jalen Madden. That is tackle number 8 for Bailey. Bailey now with 106 tackles on the season.
Yeah, you just know he kind of lived for that moment where he can meet a back 101 in the hole. And you see 9 times out of 10, he's going to take him backwards. Kyle Bailey filling that hole there. Third long here. See if pressure comes to get the ball out of Washington's hands.
This might be four down territory if he can pick up a couple here on third down. Let's see what happens. Wasink hit as he throws high and incomplete as he is dropped right on the ServPro logo around midfield. Intended receiver was Keith Mixon.
And he got some pressure right as he's about to throw the football from Clay Davis. And he takes him out kind of underneath his legs and kind of twists him a little bit, which forces that football to go a little bit high. So a big stand there from Western Kentucky after the turnover on downs. That was huge.
Broncos bring out their punt unit. Nick Mihalik will punt it away. Clayton Bush stands inside the 10-yard line. End-over-end kick. That'll hit at the 2 and bounce into the end zone. Let's go down to Dawn Davenport. Dawn?
Well, Dave, we've talked about the energy that this Western Michigan defense brings with their D.C., Lou Esposito. They are fired up right now. Their D.C. is fired up right now. I told you that it's contagious. We felt it even in the first half, even more so now. And I actually heard a couple of offensive assistants tell their guys, hey, our defense playing their tails off. We have got to match it.
Coach Espo, sixth season now at Western Michigan.
It's Big Lou right there today. Big Lou.
Here is Gage Walker on the carry. Yeah, Big Lou said it was tough last night. He's got 4 kids, right? Yep. 10 and under. A couple of twins. Yep. I think they're 4 years old. And he said one of them had a bloody nose last night. This is supposed to be like a little vacation for the family, bring them to the bowl game and stuff. Right. But he said his wife told him, this is no vacation.
She said, I'm ready to go home.
Right.
And he's like, I feel bad. I can't help her. I'm in game plan mode. I can't really go help her. So he's like, now I got to go into dad mode.
Yeah. Got to go fix a bloody nose. Ty Story with a great play fake off the right side, and he'll have the first down, and there come some flags as Story is tackled in that Hilltopper bench area by Trey Hayward.
Yeah, the veteran Hayward has to pull off just there at the end and take some all the way through.
Personal foul, number 23, defense, 15 yards added to end the run, first down.
Yeah, that's things. Western Kentucky and Ty Story do a good job on this zone replay. He pulls it out and does a really good job of running to the sideline and getting out of bounds. But Hayward right there in there, he has to just let him go. Can't continue to hang on and bring him all the way down. You're going to get that call every single time.
Yeah, First down and 10 from midfield.
You got off coverage again at the top with Lucky Jackson. See if they go that way.
Hand off to Walker. Good tackle in the open field after a gain of 3. Justin Tranquil with his 7th tackle. Justin, the senior, his final game with his teammates. We were talking yesterday at practice, watching these Western Michigan players go through, and he's talking about the last time they'll put on this helmet this weekend for many of these guys. Emotional day, right?
Yeah, no doubt. I mean, for a lot of these guys, maybe the last time you play football again in your life, so I'll leave everything on the line today.
Four-man rush. Story tried to keep his feet, but hits the deck. He'll lose a couple of yards. Ralph Holley putting the pressure on the quarterback for a loss of 5.
I mean, Ralph Holley just takes Jordan Meredith and puts him right into the lap of Ty Story. And he literally makes the play by not even making the play because he pushed the pocket so far up in the pocket. So that's an awesome effort there.
And it looked like you last it. Night.
Oh.
Make sure you get all 3 meals in. That's what I've been impressed with you. There's never a day goes by you don't get all 3 in.
I mean, you got to feel the body, man. This diet you're on, I'm not really with it.
End of the third quarter.
Well, at the end of the third quarter, DJ will get a snack. So will Ralph Holley. Got to fill the belly, right? Feed the monster, as they say. Broncos lead it by a touchdown. 15 minutes left in the Surf Pro First Responder Bowl here in Dallas, Texas. Start of the final 15, maybe more, you never know. 17-10, Western Michigan out in front of Western Kentucky. Dave Neal, former University of Georgia quarterback, DJ Shockley. Don Davenport's down the sidelines. Glad you could join us from Dallas, Texas on the campus of SMU. Ty Story, his final collegiate football game today. The grad transfer from Arkansas trying to lead a comeback for the Western Kentucky Hilltoppers. They will hand it off there to Gage Walker. And now it's 4th down. They ran it on 3rd down and a dozen. They pick up.
I think they had the mindset of thinking they would pop it to get maybe 4 or 5 yards and make the 4th down possibly a little bit more manageable, but their defense has played well, so feel good about the offensive call here.
So now it's 4th down and 8, and they will go for it again from the 49. Story back to throw. Pocket collapses. Throws to his lucky charm named Lucky Jackson. That's a 1st down, and that is yet another catch. 14 today for Lucky Jackson.
Well said there, Dave. Lucky has been his main guy today and made a bunch of plays for him. And whenever he needs it on 3rd or 4th down, Lucky is the guy. Seeing his quarterback escape out the pocket and comes out of it and just makes a nice catch on the sideline to continue this drive.
Last almost 3 games, that's 39 catches now for Lucky Jackson. Trying to hit him again, and a flag comes out as he is pushed to the turf. That'll go against Patrick Lupro down the sideline as he pushes Lucky Jackson down around the 12. Lupro said he fell on his own.
Pass interference, defense, number 4, will be a 15-yard penalty. Automatic, 1st down.
The only thing I wonder is if this football was catchable. The ball landed out of bounds, but...
Well, I got to tell you, I didn't see a whole lot there. I've seen a lot worse.
Yeah, yeah. And, I mean, it's the usual contact that you get on the outside between DBs and receivers. A little ticky-tack there for me as well.
Hilltoppers will take it. 1st and 10 from the 20. Hand it off to Gage Walker. No gain on the play.
The reason that Western Kentucky has struggled to run the football today in multiple moments is because all the movement up front by Western Michigan. They do a good job of stunning. They do a good job of moving around at the point of attack. And there's not a lot of holes for Gage Walker to run through. The times he's had some good runs have been on the perimeter.
Yeah, neither one of our run games have been explosive today. Bellamy's been held in check for Western Michigan. Gage Walker, not one of his most productive days. Coming off 119 yards in their last game, which was against Middle Tennessee back at the end of November. Story's throw to who else? Lucky Jackson. He'll get it down to the 13. That's a pickup of 8.
I got to give Story a lot of credit because you can think for so long, how long are they going to give me this? He continues to take a profit every single time by throwing his hitch route. 15 catches on the outside, most in the First Responder Bowl history. And it's been well deserved.
He had a program record 16 catches against Marshall this year, and he is certainly on pace to shatter that with 15 already and a lot of time left here. 12:40 to go in the fourth quarter. Underneath, pass is caught. Pearson. He will have the first down after the four-yard pickup hit by Trey Hayward. And that will be first and goal for the Hilltoppers.
Now, this is the most critical part of the field where you have to take care of the football. Everything shrinks down here inside the 10-yard line. He has to be really good with the football. And expect to use Ty Story in the run game, get him outside where he can use his legs as well. But this is critical down here inside the 10-yard line to take care of the football.
Story keeps it, spins inside the 5, down to the 4. Hayward with yet another stop. He's now in double figures with 10.
It's not the prettiest when Ty Story keeps the football, but it's effective. And it's enough to keep Western Michigan on their toes defensively, because a lot of times when you have these quarterbacks who don't pull it all the time and don't run as much, Ty Story has been effective each time he's run the football.
Joshua Simon, the tight end, checks back in. The 6'5 target, true freshman. Lines up in the slot to the left, but there will be a timeout taken by Tyson Helton. The Conference USA Coach of the Year in his first season timeout with the Hilltoppers calls a timeout. Back timeout in a moment.
Stream your favorite sports, stories, and series with ESPN+, Disney+, and Hulu.
Here's Tyson Helton in his first year at Western Kentucky. The team won 3 games last year. He gets the job in late November after being an offensive coordinator at Tennessee for 1 year under Jeremy Pruitt. And they are trying to rally the troops here in the ServPro First Responder Bowl. Down a touchdown, looking at a second down and goal situation. The ball sits at the 4-yard line. A couple of tight ends in the game. Gage Walker stands to the right of Story. They will hand it to Gage off the left side. Ran right into a wall of Bronco defenders. That's a loss of a yard.
Huge third down here. I expect this football to be in the hands of Ty Story. Get him on the perimeter. Get him on the edge. Give him opportunity to use his legs to run it in or even throw it. But one guy you got to keep an eye on here, as it's always been all ball game, is Lucky Jackson. In key downs and situations, Lucky Jackson has been the guy that he has looked to get the football to.
Third down and goal. Story throws on the run, touchdown Hilltoppers, and who else but Lucky Jackson.
Give that offensive line all the credit in the world. He had time to survey the entire field, starting with his progression to the left side of the field, comes all the way back around, and then Lucky Jackson just gets open, creates a zone for him to get open. Ty Story being calm inside the pocket and delivering a strike. This was excellent, excellent football and excellent quarterback play here from Ty Story.
And he just tied the program record with his 16th catch of the game. Point after is up, and it is good. How about Lucky Jackson? Came in with 77 catches, 985 yards, 3 touchdowns. Today has 16 catches for 137 and a touchdown. He has set the bowl record and just tied the program record. And the record for any bowl game, receptions in a game, is 20.
Ever. 20. Wow. There's plenty of time for that, too. 10 minutes to go in the game. There's nothing lucky about what Lucky has done today. He has created every opportunity and been just a stalemate for him on offense.
And what Tyson Helton calls a timeout, wanted to get a couple plays lined up. as they were looking at a second down and goal. And, you know, we talk about making head coaches' decisions. He's a guy in his first year as a head coach of this program, was at Western Kentucky a few years back, 14 and 15 as their OC. But he understands the game. Look, his dad, Kim, longtime collegiate coach and head coach. His brother, Clay, out of USC, is a head coach. So he understands the process. But one thing he told us yesterday was, like, it was hard. It's hard for him to give up being the guy that does all the coaching. He's got to be, like, the head coach, oversee stuff, manage stuff.
Yeah, the delegation part of it has been tough for him. And he said he just hates not being able to go and just put his hands on different positions and coach them and be in the middle of everything.
Kick taken by Mixon at the two. Keith Mixon out over the 30, breaks a tackle. Nice return from the Mississippi State transfer out to the 35-yard line. Take a look at today's clutch delivery brought to you by Chipotle.
And it's been every time that Ty Story has had to move and get outside the pocket and move. And, of course, he finds Lucky Jackson. But being able to uncover and get open for his quarterback is most important. Ty Story getting the football to Lucky Jackson in the end zone. You expect nothing else from that offense today, but those two guys to play at an elite level, and they've done it late.
That first reception was on a fourth down to keep the drive alive, and of course the last one there for the touchdown to tie this one up at 17. Inside handoff goes to Bellamy, and he's bouncing off a couple of defenders, and he will pick up about a yard when it's all over. And Western Michigan with their opportunity. Clock approaching, 10 minutes to go in this one. Bellamy, 13 carries and 34 yards. Remember, he came in with over 1,400 yards rushing and 23 rushing touchdowns. The MAC Offensive Player of the Year. Back-to-back seasons as a first-team All-MAC performer. Having a tough time today finding any room, so they'll throw it here with Wasink, and that pass is caught. Well, that's a nice job on the outside by Corey Crooms, who keeps a foot down and gets it out to the 44-yard line. That's a 20-yard pickup.
This is most probably the most confident throw I've seen. Does he get the foot down? It's a question. You see Western Michigan going fast.
Wasink's pass is caught. That one goes to Bustle, and that'll be down to the 36-yard line, a gain of 7.
I like the response here, though. Wasink, a senior quarterback who's played a tons of football for Western Michigan, and delivering here down the stretch, making some clutch throws, and probably being the most confident I've seen him in the entire ball game on this drive.
Tim Lester wants to go tempo here with his Bronco offense. They'll hand it off. Levante Bellamy has the first out at the 31.
Late in the ball game, I think you're going to get some of these advantageous boxes for Bellamy to continue to run the football. This is a guy who, in 8 games this year, rushed for over 100-plus yards. So they're not going to go away from the bell cow, who is Bellamy, running the football. And if Western Kentucky continues to only have 5-6 guys in the box, expect Washington to continue to hand this football off.
Well, Bellamy has 9 touchdown runs on the year, over 20 yards. Love to break one here. With a stiff arm, and almost had a chance to break one. He will be tripped up. He thought he was inches away. D'Angelo Malone just did get a piece of that shoelace after a gain of 6.
Yeah, the ability to change directions from D'Angelo Malone. If he doesn't get this shoestring tackle, it's going to be tough for anybody to tackle Bellamy going into the end zone, because he has the speed to get there as well. But Malone with a possibly touchdown-saving tackle.
Second down and 4. Bellamy slides to the right of Wasink. We'll run it again. And Bellamy inside the 20 will have the first down after that 6.5-yard gain.
We've seen the last 3-4 plays have been in the belly of Bellamy. And we mentioned it. They're not going to go away from what's got him here, which is running the football. And, of course, this drive started with some key throws from Wasink, but Bellamy is the guy who is going to carry you into the end zone.
This has been a nice drive by Western Michigan. After giving up the touchdown, they'll go 2 tight end set here. Run it again with Levante Bellamy. Boy, and he has been the workhorse on this drive for the Broncos. Picks up seven more. Now we're seeing why he was so effective all season long.
Yeah, and you're seeing that offensive line start to crank up as well. They're starting to get some movement up front. They're starting to get to that second level of this Western Kentucky defense.
Bellamy looks like he's a little banged up. He is was slow to get up.
Looks like Kyle Bailey as well, a little banged up for Western Kentucky.
Now Bellamy decides to sit on the turf. And, well, those are two outstanding players. Kyle Bailey with 10 tackles today for Western Kentucky with an interception, the junior linebacker. And now you get Levante Bellamy, the senior running back. He's down.
Let's go. Yeah, Bellamy's been the workhorse for him all day. And especially even more on this drive here. Has been the key to them being able to get this football down to where it's at now. They can only hope that he's okay and can return quickly.
Close it in on 1,500 yards rushing this season for Levante Bellamy. So now Sean Tyler checks in at running back, a two tight end set. Wasink spins right into trouble, tries to get the pass away, and he does. Tyler turns the corner to the five and pushed out of bounds.
Jalen Madden, number 99 for Western Kentucky, ran this the entire way. But the only thing is he's 300 pounds, and he cannot outrun. He could not run down Tucker, who had the speed to get to the corner and the edge. Love the play call screen there. Western Kentucky gets upfield. Speed of Tucker gets him all the way down inside the five-yard line.
Tyler stays in the game at running back. The true freshman in the pistol formation. They will hand it to Tyler, and he's met right at the line of scrimmage. Excuse me, Tucker with that carry.
Bellamy back into the ball game here. Of course, he wants the football's crunch situation here. Inside the five-yard line, he has a nose for the football. This guy has 23 rushing touchdowns. To put that in perspective, that's more than Chuba Hubbard. That's more than Jonathan Taylor of Wisconsin. More than J.K. Dobbins from Ohio State. He has the ability to get into the end zone.
Bellamy hit and dropped. It'll be third and goal. D'Angelo Malone, the Conference USA Defensive Player of the Year, making the play for the Hilltoppers.
What is your best play call here on third down? Inside the five-yard line, you can run it or you can throw it. But this is an opportunity where you know you're inside field goal range. You got a chance to put points on the board. What's your best call?
They'll slide Bellamy to the left. Ricci the tight end in motion. Looking to throw. Wasink to the corner of the end zone. Batted in the air and incomplete. Trying to hit Gio Ricci, the tight end. It'll be fourth and goal.
Corian Darden goes in at 5'9", 190. And you got Ricci on the outside who's 6'3", 240. And that's his third pass breakup of the ball game. Actually gets kind of blocked out, but does a good job of going over the top and knocking that football away. That's an outstanding hole for that Western Kentucky defense.
Tiago Caps, the junior kicker from Rio de Janeiro, Brazil, a junior college transfer. He has hit from 30 today. This from 20 from the far hash. Low snap. Kick is on the way. And he will hammer it through the uprights. The Broncos take the lead, under five to play in Dallas.
The Serve Pro First Responder Bowl, brought to you by 1-800-SERVE-PRO, helping make fire and water damage like it never even happened. And Lexus, experience amazing.
Pictures of Mississippi State and Louisville. Why, you ask? Well, they're coming up next. The Franklin American Mortgage Music City Bowl in Nashville. Last time they faced off in a bowl game, Lamar Jackson threw four picks in the 2017 Taxslayer Bowl as Mississippi State won 31-27. I think Lamar shook that off and continued to play at a high level.
I would say so.
Number 19 for Western Kentucky is now number 62.
So the field goal gives Western Michigan the three-point lead. 4:58 to play. Kick bobbled around the 10-yard line by LaFrance, but he comes back near side and ends up making a decent return out of that, out over the 30-yard line. Mississippi State's had one of those up-and-down seasons, and they're going to turn it over to Tommy Stevens to run the show for the Bulldog offense. And obviously there's been a lot of talk about what happened at a practice and bowl games. Garrett Schrader was a starting quarterback, the freshman. Apparently he got into a little bit of a scuffle with a teammate and not going to be able to perform physically today. So Stevens, who's been the transfer quarterback, will get the start today for the Bulldogs against the Louisville Cardinals as they are back in a bowl game after a decent season this year. Of course, last year was a real struggle for the Louisville Cardinals. Scott Satterfield kind of settled things down. On the first play, they try to go to the tight end. That will not be completed. Second down and 10.
Trying to sneak him out there. Simon's been a big part of this ball game today. 6'5", 235 freshman has been impressive to watch today, and they try to sneak him out for a big play there to start this drive.
Second down and 10. Story. Wide open is Simon. Inside the 40, down to the 39. The true freshman tied in, stepping up with a big play of 30 yards.
How about the touch by Ty Story, dropping his football right over the linebackers and right into the hands of Simon, and him understanding where that voided zone is. Huge play there on second down, and plenty of time here for Ty Story. And what a perfect ending to this ball game if it would be for Ty Story in his last ball game to be able to take his team down and to get big time points on a possible touchdown here that could put him ahead.
They have to take a timeout. Play clock was down to 2 seconds, and they were not close to getting it off. So Hilltoppers take the timeout. Back in a moment.
Western Kentucky.
Stream your favorite sports, stories, and series with ESPN.
Corey Munson, who has struggled down the stretch. He has hit just two of his last six field goals, and he's missed them all inside 33 yards. Those four misses. Dawn, what's it like down there?
Well, hey, the wind has started to pick up. Started the fourth quarter, picked up big time, and it'll be behind his back. It's blowing left to right.
Will it come down to the true freshman out of Warner Robins? We'll find out. Western Kentucky out of the pistol formation. First down and 10 inside the 40-yard line. Little toss. Lucky Jackson turns the corner. First down, and he gets out of bounds. Just shy of the 25-yard line. That's a gain of 11.
Good block, good block on the outside by Parker Howell. They bring the pressure from the inside, but the run goes on the perimeter, so they stretch it all the way out, and there's no danger of getting any tackle for loss there. And, of course, Lucky Jackson makes a huge run.
That goes down as a pass, a little tap pass. So it's 17 catches now. A new school record for Lucky Jackson. He is three shy of the all-time collegiate bowl record of 20.
Love those little tap passes. Count as completions.
Yeah, I know you would. Nothing there for Gage Walker. That'll be a loss of a yard. Hey, fans, tune in to the ESPN app for the postgame trophy ceremony presented by Capital One immediately following this game as it's coming down to the wire. Western Kentucky, 3.5-point favor coming into this one. A lot of people at home probably paying attention to the score right now.
Yeah, been a back-and-forth game. Both teams have struggled at times, but this is the clutch moment of the ball game where it matters, and can Ty Story be the difference here late?
Pressure comes. Hilltoppers pick it up. Pass is caught inside the 15. Again, the tight end, Joshua Simon, who has had a heck of a day, 14 more yards.
Yeah, the size of Joshua Simon is the difference. His 6'5 frame actually just blocks off A.J. Thomas, who in the back end comes from behind. But Story does a good job of putting it on that back shoulder, forcing him to back into the catch. And he just kind of blocks him out.
First down. Story to throw underneath, and that one almost picked off. Overthrew Pearson. And lucky that wasn't intercepted.
Yeah, just an unorthodox throw there from Ty Story. He has him running wide open and throws it high and a little behind him. If he catches that in stride, he has a chance to turn in his shadow and get vertical and possibly get into the end zone. But Tranquil there for the possible deflection. And that's what you cannot have down here is any kind of high or deflected throw.
Story 33 of 46, 327 yards. It is second down and 10. Hand it off to Walker. He'll pick up a couple of yards before he is thrown to the turf. Spears and Holly combined for the tackle for the Broncos. Now it's third down and about 8.
If you're Western Kentucky, or if you're Western Michigan, you should double number 11 right now. Lucky Jackson should not catch this football. He has been the killer for Western Michigan all game long.
Pressure comes. Story to the end zone. Overthrows Lucky Jackson, and now it's fourth down. And here comes the true freshman, Corey Munson, who was 1 out of 2 today and missed one earlier. A short chippy right before halftime from 26 yards out. Or excuse me, that was from 29. He made from 26. On the year, he is 15 out of 26. This from 31 yards. Snap is good. Kick is on the way, and he splits the upright, and we are tied at 20. .136 to play. Broncos have 3 timeouts. They'll get the football when we come back. Western Kentucky just tied it up at 20. Now Western Michigan will try to answer, but it's getting late. .136 to play in the 2019 version of the ServPro First Responder Bowl. All 3 timeouts remaining for the Broncos. 1 timeout left for Western Kentucky. A drive that stalled inside the 15-yard line. And now they'll turn it over to their senior, John Wasink, who the last 2 years for their senior quarterback ended with injuries. Missed the last 4 games in 17 and 18. Oh, and this one's been touched by the Broncos, but Mixon will pick it up. He's out to the 15. And a long way to go now for Western Michigan. Hey, Wild Card Weekend begins January 4th, and we'll broadcast our game simultaneously on ESPN and ABC for the 5th straight year. Buffalo at Houston, a couple of 10-6 clubs coming your way, 4:35 p.m. Eastern time. You can always watch it live, of course, on the ESPN app from anywhere.
Dave, these are the moments that are made for guys like Wasink. Last ball game of his career, has an opportunity to go down and win his ball game. And have a good honeymoon, too.
Wasink will throw on first down. Pass is caught out around the 23-yard line by Keith Mixon. Darden brings him down, a gain of 8. And there'll be a timeout taken by timeout. Western Michigan.
Western Michigan, it's the first charge timeout. 30-second timeout. Please reset the game clock to 1:22, please. Thank you.
Don't forget, coming up after this one, Franklin American Mortgage Music City Bowl from Nashville, Tennessee, Mississippi State, and Louisville. All 5 of Louisville's losses this season have come by double digits, but they did find a way to push their record to 7-5 after a 1-10 season a year ago. A win would match Louisville's biggest wind jump from 1 year to the next in school history. 1:22 to go here in Dallas, Texas. Gerald Ford Stadium here on the campus of SMU. Wassing going up top. That one is incomplete, just overthrew his intended receiver on the far side, Corey Crooms. Now it's third down and a couple.
Yeah, he just got to give his receiver an opportunity. That ball was 5-6 yards overthrown. In situations like this, anything can happen. You can get a pass interference, anything in that situation is probably better for the offense. Just give your receiver an opportunity to catch the football. But now you got to convert this third down, or you give Western Kentucky probably pretty good field position.
Ricci to tight end in motion. Looking this way. Passes caught. That'll be good enough for the first down at the 29 by Gio Ricci, the tight end. And go to your money man, right?
Yeah, he's the most reliable guy. Uses that big frame of his at 6'3", 240 to shield the ball in a very accurate pass to complete that first down.
Quick snap here. Wassink going near sideline. Pass is caught. Oh, what a grab. Deshaun Bustle with the catch of the day. 33 yards, and he is injured in the process.
That's an outstanding catch there. Giving up his body, laying out to go get that football and coming down with it. Right in the key moment where your team needs you. Bustle comes out with a top 10 catch.
The ruling on the field is a completed catch. The previous play is under further review.
First look says catch. Let's see what second look says to us.
I don't think there's nothing that says this ball is not caught. He gets two hands underneath this football. Both arms are underneath it. You see, as he goes to the ground, as he goes to the ground, he actually curls his arms underneath the football. This is a magnificent catch from Bustle, coming up with a huge play, and Ruffin is the defender that's beat on it, but that's just an outstanding throw and catch from Wassink to Bustle.
A redshirt freshman out of Knoxville, Tennessee, with the catch of the day. I'm with you. There's nothing there that makes me think that that's not a catch, although who knows what a catch is?
Anymore, been wrong, right? Before. We've seen some ones who look less egregious, been overturned. So, but I would pretty much guarantee that this is probably going to be a catch.
Well, Jeremy Parker with
the ruling on the field of a catch is confirmed. First down.
Yes, catch on the way. Looking at Bustle now. He left the game, maybe just knocked the wind out of him as he fell on that football, but he is jumping around on that Western Michigan sideline, getting some pats on the back from his teammates as the Broncos line it up from the 37-yard line.
Plenty of time, 54 seconds on the clock for Western Michigan.
Four-man rush. Ricci with that catch down to the 35, only a couple of yards there. Again, you know, both these teams have had their issues kicking field goals. Thiago Capps kind of lost the job to Gavin Petty. Capps has the strong leg. Petty is the guy who's more accurate. But Capps won the job this last couple of weeks of practice. And today has hit from 30 and 20 yards. He's got the bigger leg of the two. Wassink trying to run for inside the 30 and gets hit and dropped around the 28-yard line. That's a gain of 7. Another timeout taken. 37 seconds to play.
Western Michigan, their second charge timeout. 30-second timeout.
Hey, tonight after the Orange Bowl, stick around for SportsCenter with Scott Van Pelt. He'll have postgame coverage from Hard Rock Stadium. Plus, which head coaches are out and what's next for those teams? and the worst beats of the year. And there have been some bad ones. You won't want to miss that. SportsCenter with SVP after Florida, Virginia on ESPN and, of course, the ESPN app.
I love the timeout call there to set yourself up. It's third and one here. Instead of rushing up to the line of scrimmage, you still had two timeouts. So now you allow everybody to regroup, and you get your best third down call here to pick up this first down. And then you start managing this clock to set yourself up for the field goal.
Here's the young man out of Rio de Janeiro, Brazil. Thiago Caps waiting for an opportunity. Third and a yard. Oh, my goodness. Wasink.
Oh, no.
Had the first down and a lot more, and he loses two as he stumbles out of the gate. Oh, my goodness. Now it's fourth down and three.
Western Michigan.
And by the way, he fell in late there.
This will be a one-minute timeout.
The perfect call. Western Kentucky, they sailed out for the run up the middle. And Wasink, maybe he could probably score on this if he keeps his feet. But he for sure has a first down. There's nobody within 15, 20 yards of him.
Oh, my goodness. Look at all that space.
So much room to run.
31 seconds, please. 31.
I mean, you're looking at a 52-yard field goal into the wind.
Those are times where you're so excited because you see it. It's like a quarterback and the guy's wide open and you overthrow him. The easiest of plays sometimes come hard and that one there is something he will remember for a long time, and you see them laughing about it.
I need to correct myself. Ball's at the 30. I was thinking 35, so 47-yard attempt, and Cap certainly can hit that. His long of the year is 45. Hit that against Montana. Oh, boy. I mean, that just,
Oh, man.
Will it be Wasink? Or will it be Caps? Which 16 will we see here? And it is Wasink on the field. They're going to go for it on fourth down and three.
One guy you got to keep an eye on. Where's Richie aligned? Gio Richie is aligned at the top of the screen.
Wasink throws on the run, batted away, and Western Kentucky stops it on fourth down, and they'll get the football with 27 seconds to play.
Just the close on that route there. You had it perfectly what you wanted. I thought the ball may have been a tad bit late, allowing the DB to get over the top and Darden and knock that football away.
DeCorian Darden has four PBUs today. The team has six. What a day for DeCorian Darden in the back end of this Hilltopper defense. What do you think about the play call?
I don't mind the play call because it's there. But I thought at the top of it, Washington took two extra steps. And on that sprint out, on your fifth step, the ball should have been out.
Down the middle. Oh, just off the fingertips. Had a chance for Pearson, who laid out and just missed it.
They absolutely had a chance there, running right through the middle. If Ty Story puts that football on him, not only does the clock stop, you pick up huge yards on first down. Now you got an opportunity. And Ty Story knows he missed the big one right there.
Ty Story today, 33 of 48, 327. His second game of 300-plus passing yards. Story stands in the pocket, drops it off underneath, gets it to Gage Walker, who gets out of bounds over the 40, but 15 seconds on the clock. That's a gain of 11.
If you're Western Kentucky, you still got another timeout, so you can throw the football in the middle of the field if you want to, but this is an opportunity with only 15 seconds. You still need a chunk play here to help with your field goal or help with just getting the football down.
Two plays for sure, maybe three. Story That one is through the hands of Lucky Jackson. He was trying to pick up his 18th catch of the day, but he'll have to wait for that. 17 catches, 148 yards for Lucky Jackson today. A school record, a bowl record. So now you have 11 seconds.
Last time Western Michigan played two-man, which is why you had the underneath for the running back to run through. See if they play something similar here, which keeps somebody over the top and underneath.
Four-man rush by the Broncos. Story. He will get it to Walker, and he's out of bounds inside the 40 with 3 seconds to go. They'll spot it at the 39. So roughly a 56-yard kick if you want to take that opportunity.
What a play there by Storr. I mean, that was innovative, and you had an opportunity, but good job of getting out of bounds there, understanding the clock, understanding where you are on the field, and they're going to take a moment to think about it.
Western Kentucky, their third and final timeout. This will be a one-minute timeout.
Munson's career long is 48. Hit that against Charlotte this year. This would be about a 57-yarder. What do you do? What do you do, Shock?
You got 3 seconds. I say try it. You got the wind at your back. You look juiced up at the end of the ball game. Give Munson an opportunity to go for it and be the hero. But if you do kick it, you have to tell your guys, because they're probably going to have somebody back there to cover it. Make sure you cover this kick just in case you don't make it and you come up short.
And this happened right before the end of the first half. He missed it from 29 yards out, a chip shot. Matter of fact, his misses of late have all been inside 33 yards, so maybe you do give him the long shot. Well, Tyson Helton, first year coach in Western Kentucky with the decision here, and it looks like he's going to keep his offense on the field. Ty Story back on the field. They'll go three receivers to the near side.
Crazier things have happened. You can try to throw this football into the end zone. If you get a possible pass interference, that gives you a better chance at a field goal.
Boy, Western Michigan having a tough time getting lined up. They want illegal substitution over there on the far side. Tyson Helton over there jumping up and down, but here we go.
Oh,
and I think
that
there were too many men on the field. There was. Did they get somebody off in time? Our officials are talking to each other on the back end. Tyson Helton on the far side was jumping up and down. He wanted to.
There is no foul for substitution. I have not marked the ball ready for play. It's first down.
Boy, a lucky break there for Western Michigan as they were scrambling, getting guys on the field. They'll put four all the way back at the goal line. And now here comes the field goal unit. Now they decide to kick it.
Western Kentucky scrambling now.
Boy, all kinds of things are going on. Play clock hasn't started yet. Now the offense is back on the field. Mass confusion. So here we go. Final play of regulation. Story to the end zone. In the air, and it is batted down, and we are headed to overtime. Boy, that was an anticlimactic 3 seconds.
Oh, we got a flag.
Do we have a flag? Wait a minute. Hold on. There is a flag down around the 20-yard line. So is it over in regulation?
Western Kentucky thinks the same. It feels like it's on Western Michigan.
Hey, Hey, guys. Western Kentucky coaching staff here is saying that they had 12 on the field. They were going crazy. Right after that is when that flag came in.
Well, they're talking about maybe there were 12 players on the field again.
And the thing to wonder is, I know they had Sky Moore on the field for Western Michigan, who was an extra receiver on the field.
The previous play is under further review.
And then there are three guys in the back end, maybe four. They lined up four before, but we just can't see on our shot exactly how many players there are on the field because we just can't capture that goal line. But initially, before they brought the field goal unit out, they had four guys, but we see three clearly in this shot, which would give them 11.
And I guarantee you there's another guy outside of the hash here because they would not just have the three guys inside here. So if that's the case.
But again, if we can't see, they're trying to count them up. Tyson Helton said there's 12 by his math. Well, this has been a
crazy ending to this ball game here.
I don't know if it's as crazy as what we saw last night between San Francisco and Seattle, right? But still, nonetheless, this is a wacky ending to this game. We're not even here if Wasink on a third down and two
falls down. Yeah.
If he doesn't fall down on an easy bootleg, it would have picked up 15 yards. Instead, he fell down and forced a fourth down incomplete pass. All right, let's see if we can count.
See, here's the fourth guy outside the hash who I was talking about.
So there were 12. Because we can count them all the way up until the back end, and now we can get a look at the back end.
Right, because we can see the first three guys and the guy outside the hash here. Yeah.
So we're going to count them up here for you, up front, what we can see from this angle. And then we'll show you what it's like on the back end, and there should be four guys on the back end.
Well, we'll see the three guys who are in the shot down the middle, but we can't see the guy who's outside the hash.
Right.
There's the three guys across the back, the front end line, and then the fourth guy, number 13, who was sitting outside the hash. That is absolutely 12 guys on the field.
And there he is, sitting near the 10-yard line.
It's an awesome job there piecing that together.
That would give Western Kentucky an opportunity. So now the question becomes, do you run the field goal unit back out?
You got to give them a chance.
The foul for substitution with 12 in the formation is confirmed. We have one untimed down.
Give them a shot at it.
And will 46 come on the field? Yes, he will. Corey Munson, the freshman, the true freshman out of Warner Robins, Georgia. Two out of three today. His long is 48. This will be from 52 yards from the far hash mark. John Haggerty, the punter, will hold. Jared Nash will snap it. It's definitely long and they're up and it is good!
Unbelievable!
The true freshman, Corey Munson, hammers it home from 52 yards. And they got there because Western Michigan had 12 on the field.
There was no doubt about that kick. And the fact that it happened twice, Western Michigan had 12 on the field twice, which enabled that to happen. What a clutch kick there to win the ball game.
You know what? He would have made that for 57. I don't know why they didn't kick it the first time. Wow, what a finish. It was crazy, confusing, but yet Western Kentucky will take it. And Corey Munson, our Capital One player of the game. The game-winning 52-yard bullet right through the uprights. So the final score, Western Michigan can't hold on as the Hilltoppers storm back to win it 23-20. For DJ Shockley, Dawn Davenport, I'm Dave Neal. Time to get you out to the Franklin American Mortgage Music City Bowl, Mississippi State and Louisville. Thanks for watching and so long from Dallas. The ServPro First Responder Trophy Ceremony presented by Capital One. The festivities down on the field are about to begin, but first, this message. Promise that you'll never find another like me.
With the Capital One Saver Card, you earn 4% cash back on dining and 4% on entertainment. So when you go out, you cash in. What's in your wallet?
Our Capital One player of the game right there, Corey Munson, the true freshman kicker. As we take a look at today's Capital One rewarding performance. Glorious yards if you're a Hilltopper fan, but not so much for the Broncos.
Unbelievable walk-off by Munson there to give his team a win. And what an unbelievable game this was, coming down to the wire, back and forth. And the Western Kentucky Hilltoppers coming out on top in dramatic fashion.
Let's go down to Dawn, who's caught up with Coach Helton.
Whew, I tell you what, Coach Helton, dramatic fashion, a true freshman gets it done. What was going through your mind during that last drive?
Well, I knew he was due. You know, he's had his ups and downs through the season, and I kept saying, hey, we're going to keep putting you out there. We're going to keep putting you out there. And it's hard being a true freshman sometimes, being a kicker, but this was the perfect stage for him to go make a classic kick, and I'm so proud of him for getting it done for us. That was a huge, huge kick.
Apparently, this group didn't get the memo that this was a rebuilding year, right? Win number 9 for you guys. What does it mean to be able to do that in your first year after a 3-win season last year?
Well, it's a big step for us. We never use the word rebuilding. Every year is a new year. You know, your goal is to win championships every single year. And our kids just battle. They fight. They come out to play. It's a great ending to a great season, and now next season we'll have to take another step.
Defensively, I don't know if you can say enough about what that unit did. What impressed you most about what they gave you today?
Well, they just keep you in the game. I mean, they give you every opportunity to try to go win games. And all year we've played good team football. We knew our defense was our strength. And, you know, we knew if we could get to the last 5 minutes and have a chance, we could go win the game. And that's what happened.
Ty Story, you talked about his leadership and how he was ready even when he wasn't the guy at the beginning of this year. What has he meant to this team this year?
He's been huge. He's our rock. He's the guy that everybody circles around and believes in. We know we always have a chance when Ty's out there playing. I'm really proud, though, of all our seniors. I mean, they stepped up to play. Lucky Jackson was huge today. Again, you know, Quinn Dern again was great again. It's just a great ending to a really good season. I can't be any more happier for our seniors.
Coach, congratulations.
Thank you very much. Appreciate it.
What a turnaround. What a turnaround for the Hilltoppers. 3 wins a year ago. Push it out to 9 this year with this bowl victory capping things off. What a day for the Hilltoppers. Lucky Jackson, a big part of that. A bowl record, a school record. 17 catches for 148 yards today. He was confident in our meetings yesterday. I think after this game, he might be a little bit more confident.
As he should be. And what they gave him today was something that you don't give a big-time receiver who came into the game with 77 catches. And when he had off coverage, he made him pay because he made the next guy miss, and he was able to do this all day long. They put him on the inside in the slot. That's when he started his career, came outside, and was really the threat that they needed throughout this ball game. And every time they need a big time catch on third or fourth down, Ty Story looked the same way and went to Lucky Jackson, and he never let him down. So a huge day for Lucky Jackson in his last game as a Hilltopper, and it's one I'm sure he will never forget because of the effort he put out today.
He just probably woke up a lot of NFL scouts today too.
Absolutely.
35 of 51, 358. For Ty Story, a couple of touchdowns and 2 picks as well. What a day for Western Kentucky. It looked like they were in control of this game most of the afternoon. But it took a while for them. Let's go down to the field in the trophy presentation. Here's Dawn Davenport.
Assistant VP and Director of Marketing. We now go down to ESPN's Dawn Davenport.
I tell you what.
For introductions to today's MVP honoree.
What a game we had today. Let's hear it from both of these teams. Football game right there. Congratulations to Western Kentucky, the ServPro First Responder Bowl champions, and a big part of that victory. Our MVP today. Let's hear it with 17 catches. Lucky Jackson. Now, you told me you want to talk. So I'm going to ask you a question. How big is this? This team comes in, this senior class, what you guys were able to do. You battle some adversity, and you win it like this. What does that mean for this program?
Oh, man, it's just a big deal. I mean, we fought full 4 quarters as a team, and this group of brothers came together, and we stuck together. And, I mean, look at everybody out here. I mean, it's a big family. I mean, without these guys and God, I mean, none of this would be possible. So, I mean, shout out to the team, the coaches, and all the support staff.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
All right, let's get Coach Helton up here. Coach Helton, you're on the other side of me. Here to present our ServPro First Responder Bowl champion is the Assistant VP of Marketing, Chad Lewis.
Coach, congratulations. Fantastic game, guys. That was pretty awesome. So on behalf of ServPro's 1,700 nationwide franchises and first responders everywhere, congratulations for being the champions of the ServPro First Responder Bowl. Congratulations.
Celebrate with with your team, but just a couple of quick questions. 9 wins in your first year after just 3 wins for this program last year. What does that mean to you and to do it with this group?
Well, I'll be honest with you. We were able to win it because those fans standing back behind over there. I just want to say a big go Tops to our fans coming out today. They've been with us thick and thin. We took a big step this year, and we need to take another big step next year, but we're really happy today.
You saw the 12 men on the field. I was standing right there as you went crazy on that sideline. What was going through your mind in that moment?
Well, I knew that when they had 12 that we'd have the opportunity to make the kick. And I was really hoping we would because I wanted our freshman kicker, Corey Munson, to go kick it. And he stepped up to the plate and made a big one today.
A true freshman. What did you say to him before he had it out there? What was the conversation?
I looked at him. He looked at me. We didn't have any words. I nodded at him just like I am now. And I knew he was going to go make it. So.
Congratulations, Coach. Western Kentucky, your Serve Pro First Responder Bowl champion.
Thank you, guys. Appreciate it. Go Tops.
We'll let you go celebrate, guys. Back to you.
Well, thank you for watching the ESPN app postgame trophy ceremony presented by Capital One. Western Kentucky, your Serve Pro First Responder Bowl champions. Good night from Dallas.